outside the board and free from the hive mind, this is Rex Bear, hosting Leap Project. The Leap Project was created to offer awareness and information not found in the mainstream news. With over 90% of the world's media controlled by only six enormous conglomerates, many people today are looking for more accurate information. The Leap Project offers a refreshing approach to the brain-drained media. Check back daily for new content as we thrive to bring you the cutting edge in news, current events, on-scene video footage, interviews, and most importantly, the truth. Tonight's guest is Douglas Dietrich, one of the most knowledgeable, controversial, and outspoken individuals on many fascinating subjects you don't learn about in school or the mainstream news. Even the alternative media has very little insight and information about much of what Douglas knows and has seen with his own two eyes. For 8 years, Douglas Dietrich was a research librarian for the Department of Defense at El Presidio, Real D, San Francisco military base. There, along with his primary duty of document destruction, he was assigned to locate and access incredibly rare occult grimoires for the officially recognized Satanic Chaplain of the United States Army, Lieutenant Colonel Michael A. Aquino. Douglas claims the true origins of America are far different than you're taught in school. Be prepared for a shocking and controversial interview that will change the paradigm of most belief systems. Mr. Dietrich speaks of occultism and Satanism within the U.S. military. Then he discusses his evidence on child abuse, pornography, blackmail, and mind control in the military and U.S. government. Douglas, it's great to have you on the show here at Leak Project. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me. It's really great to be here. Been a long time since the... And definitely we'll cover just a bit of the old days and get into what's going on now.
Great. And Douglas, I'd like to give you an open canvas here tonight here on the Leak Project. I'm sure you're going to bring up a plethora of topics and information. So if you would, please, how long were you in the military and what was your connection with Michael Aquino?
The military, an extraordinarily short period of time. That has nothing to do with my experience with shall we say, in as facetious a manner as possible, the good colonel. He retired as a full bird colonel. Of course, he never retired as a general, nor did any of his affiliates because of the infamy and the baggage that was placed upon them, which they're all quite bitter about, but, you know, such is karma and sour grapes. But in terms of the affiliates I'm speaking of, just so that we can get back to them later, speaking of lieutenant colonel, at the time that I worked with them, all of these men were lieutenant colonels, and that would include James Channon and, of course, Colonel John Alexander. Now, all of these people, Colonel John Alexander, Colonel James Channon, Colonel Michael Aquino, they all retired with a full bird, as they say. In other words, they retired in colonelcy, but they didn't retire in generalcy. And in the place of that...
What does that mean?
Well, that would mean that they didn't retire as generals, which, of course, is what a commissioned officer would hope to do. Basically, what happens is if someone is, say, just behaving themselves and going to class every day, it's kind of like community college or today's sense of collegiate status. Everybody graduates. You know, all you have to do is show up for class every day. You might graduate with a real low grade, but eventually you're going to graduate. Nobody really looks at the grades unless someone's emphasizing it on their resume that they're magna cum laude or something of that nature. Instead, people will just say, oh, okay, he graduated. Now, of course, that has, as we progress into the postmodern age, less and less meaning. Education has gotten people less and less the higher their education. And in the case of the military, it's a lot like that. You basically have people who are commissioned as officers. Now, the difference between a non-commissioned and a commissioned officer is basically this. I'll go into this now because it's important. A non-commissioned officer is anyone from an enlisted man all the way up to the rank of Sergeant First Class or Master Sergeant or, in the case of the Navy, Chief Petty Officer. And you have this very bizarre kind of gray area known as warrant officers. Warrant officers are the best of both worlds, where they're not commissioned, but at the same time, nobody can touch them because their specialty is valuable enough where officers can't chew them out or put them in the brig. So they have everybody by the balls, so to speak, by the value of their technical expertise. And they just kind of meander about as old men who are supposedly helping the military to function smoothly, which of course it does anything but. Now, in terms of the non-commissioned peoples, this goes all the way back to George Washington and, of course, their officer class. The non-commissioned peoples, from enlisted men up to the sergeants and the like, they are considered mercenaries. They're considered the absolute bottom of the barrel. They're considered the scum of the earth. They're spit upon by the officers as human fecal matter, except it's below fecal matter, because fecal matter can fertilize the soil, and you get enough rabbit shit and you can grow yourself some plants. Okay, these people are worthless for even that, as far as an officer is concerned. They're just human garbage to be expended, to be killed, to be sacrificed, to be tortured, to be experimented upon. That's what happens to them. You join the military, that's what happens to you. So in terms of what these non-commissioned officers have made the mistake of doing is they've entered a service, which is called a service because you serve. You're not working for remuneration. You're essentially stripped of everything. You're stripped of your humanity. You're stripped of your future. Nothing you learn will be employable in the civilian world. You will enter a world where you're repairing tank treads for the next 20 years. You go out to get a job in a garage. You will be entirely unemployable because there's no one who needs you to repair tank treads. You'll learn to operate a radar, radio detection and ranging. It's going to be absolutely useless in the real world. It will have nothing to do even if you try to get a job with air traffic control. That's why most people in air traffic control have never had military experience. It's basically untransferable, any of your experience, so don't do it. Whatever you do, don't go in the military. You know, we can go into that later for other reasons, but basically, as a non-commissioned person, you are not commissioned, and therefore, you are subject to one thing that is supposed to be in your favor. If you don't get paid, you don't have to fight. Now, that's all per the Uniform Code of Military Justice, and it's all in theory, but it is there, and when crunch comes to shove, it does mean something. Now, at the Battle of Gettysburg, which is largely and popularly considered, for what it's worth, to be the turning point of the American Civil War between the states. That doesn't mean to be. That doesn't mean that it's historically inviolate. That doesn't mean that Gettysburg was it, but Gettysburg was undeniably and inarguably very decisive. Now, Gettysburg was therefore something we should pay attention to. And what happened at that battle that could have been the turning point? All of the Union officers, the commissioned officers, were so corrupt, were so incompetent, were so vile as a class of people that they had never paid their troops for months and months and months, the better part of well over a year. So they were busy stealing all the money. They were busy stealing the payroll. And at the Battle of Gettysburg, all of the troops realized, you know what? We don't need to suffer this. And so they said, we can all go home. And so all of the generals, I'm not talking lieutenants, I'm not talking colonels, I'm talking generals, the field generals, had to go out in the field, hat in hand, begging the troops to fight to continue this grand experiment in union to bring their errant brothers, the so-called rebels, back into the fold by force. And these non-commissioned personnel were all so stupid, so brainwashed, so incredibly naive that they went for it. And the Battle of Gettysburg was carried in Union favor, to great misfortune of the entire world, including the African-American population. None of this was, of course, being fought for their benefit. All of this was fought for entirely different reasons from, quote-unquote, freedom of the slaves, because Abraham Lincoln had every intention of deporting every single black man and woman and child in America back to Africa as soon as he won the war. The only thing that stopped it was that a Confederate soldier blew his brains out. So you have a case of pure raw evil was intended towards the black population and towards the white population, which the Union had intended genocide for. And the only reason they didn't succeed in that was because the Southern population resisted, created a resistance movement, which had its own problems, its own infamy, known as the Ku Klux Klan, carried the day in terms of preventing white extermination during the era of Reconstruction, and then eventually, as many terrorists or resistance movements do, degenerate it into its own form of corruption and internal politics and kind of what we have today. Now, whether any of that can ever be rehabilitated is, of course, up to future generations to decide or this generation to decide. But my point should be well taken about the corruption of the Civil War because it goes into how the military runs this country. Now, in terms of all of these men fighting when they shouldn't have fought because they had never been paid, we go back to the commissioned officers. Now, what's the commissioned officer status mean? What does that mean when you're commissioned? It means that you have stock in the Incorporated States of America. That means America, the United States of America, is a corporation. You are a shareholder. You own stock in the nation. You do not have to be paid to fight. You have to fight no matter what because you've signed away the future of your entire family as investiture into the United States of America as a constitutional republic. Therefore, as a commissioned officer, you fight to the death. That is the theory. That is the difference between the commission and the non-commission. Now, for this reason, commissioned officers who all know this, who are all educated in this, who are all initiated into this, this is why they hold enlisted men in utter contempt. They view them as mercenaries. Now, how did this all start? It started with George Washington and his co-conspirators who served as the world's first conservative insurgency. And by conservative, I'm implying both political and financial, meaning they had something to conserve. Basically, what had happened was the royal proclamation that was issued by King George of the United Kingdom and the British Empire. And basically, in the 1700s, he issued a proclamation known as the Royal Proclamation, which said that the Atlantic states that formed the colonies of the Atlantic seaboard of the Maritime Republic of the United States, as we came to know it very shortly after the conservative insurgency began to unfold, was originally, of course, Royal America. Americans were known as Royal Americans, and many Americans had absolutely no reason to be dissatisfied with the lifestyle that they had under King George. So what happened was you had a King George who said, by the way, I don't want you colonizing any further inland. The beyond the Appalachian Mountains, we have French America. And French America is in a state of idyll. In other words, it's in a state of peace, meaning that the French traders, the fur traders, various other kinds of traders of French mercantile intent, were doing quite well marrying Native Americans. Their intercourse with Native Americans was probably the most progressive of all of the colonial powers. And they were doing a stunning business trading with the Indians and bringing their goods into what later became the United States. So King George said, there's no reason to interfere with that. Things are going quite well. You will colonize no further because so far you have been responsible for massive genocide and irresponsibility towards the native and indigenous peoples in your territories. And therefore, I don't want you destroying any more lives. Now, at that point in time, George Washington was known as the village burner in the Mohawk language because he had slaughtered thousands of Indians by burning their villages with all the women, children, and elderly inside and bayoneting and shooting all of the refugees as they tried to escape the burning villages to avoid burning alive. So he covered genocidal actions over multiple states in the United States that resulted in the murder of tens of thousands, ultimately hundreds of thousands of Indians. Personally oversaw this. So the man was psychotic. He was deranged. He was a mass murderer. He was a piece of human shit. And so this is your founding father, and it's gotten worse ever since. Now, George Washington made himself a commissioned officer. He commissioned himself as the general of the armies that founded this rotten republic, which we're all stranded in. And this individual, of course, got together with a bunch of other scumbags known as the founding fathers, such as, of course, Benjamin Franklin, Thomas Jefferson. These were criminals, and they were basically a bunch of white slave-owning, plantation-owning, misogynist pricks who said, let's start our own empire and tell King George to go F himself because we want it all. We want the entire continent. We'll take French America. We're going to stretch America from sea to shining sea. And they said, we're going to kill all the Indians and we'll steal all their land. We'll have it all for ourselves because we're conservative and we've got plantations. We've got slaves. We want it all and we want it to stay that way forever. So anyone who looks back on this as some noble experiment is truly a fool. Especially if you're black. You're a black fool. If you think there's anything good in these founding fathers, they would have thought of you as a piece of human excrement, just like they think of everyone else, just like your leaders today of your military junta who run your nation think of you. And, of course, these were people who said that as commissioned officers who own stock in the nation, all of our enlisted men are expendable. So their enlisted men were the version of feudal serfs. These were like people who were like tilling the soil on their lands. And these people were pretty much helpless. And they were the peasantry of the United States. So when the longest declared war in American history took place, the longest declared war was the American Revolutionary War of Independence. It lasted 8 years from 1775, when the shot that was fired was heard around the world, 1775, all the way up to 1783 or something like that, when the British were forced to withdraw, you had an eight-year period of very terrible conflict in which Americans were fighting Americans because there were many Americans who fought against these scumbags. There were Americans who were loyal to the king. Those are the true heroes. And those individuals wanted to remain loyal to the crown instead of becoming traitors. And they were often annihilated and executed. And when the scumbags went out and established the genocidal republic, which later on turned its attentions towards the Indians inland and proceeded to exterminate so many more of them, we had a situation in which George Washington was able to give his version of a Gettysburg Address. And at that point, he said absolutely nothing about his enlisted men in terms of credit. He credited all his fellow commissioned officers for winning the war. Because as far as he was concerned, his enlisted men were nothing but subhuman peasants that were meant to take bullets. Now, anyone who has any doubt of this, just need to look up Shay's Rebellion. And what had happened was all of these enlisted men who had fought for 8 years lost everything because when you're called to fight, the reason you don't have to fight if you don't get paid is because, think back to when they were fighting those times. These were men who lived off the land. These were men whose women and children, their families, depended on their being at home to stave off raiders, whether Indian or white. And they not only needed to be home to defend their families, they needed to be there to work the land. If they were not there to till the land, no crops were going to get grown. And women and children are not physically capable of plowing, tilling, and doing everything else with the industriousness of your average male. And as a result, entire families starved to death. Your family could die. They could be raped, killed, murdered while you were gone by raiders, again, either Indian or white. They could be, of course, basically starving to death because they couldn't work the land. And as a result, of course, you were sacrificing everything while fighting for these conservative scumbags who owned plantations and slaves and were living fat and talking about high ideals when they want to steal the rest of the continent, kill the Indians, and take everything else for themselves. Now, who wants to fight for that? Nobody sane wants to fight for that. So if you're not getting paid, you don't have to fight. So guess what? None of them got paid. So your original Ben Franklin, your original Thomas Jefferson, your original George Washington, all of these scumbags were so criminal that they never paid their men. And as a result, the men held Shays' Rebellion. They marched on the capital of Philadelphia. They pointed their muskets at the likes of Thomas Jefferson, at the likes of Hamilton and the rest of the original founding fathers, demanded their payment, and, of course, suffered the consequences of being attacked by the U.S. Army that was in service at the time, because other men getting paid are willing to kill men who didn't get paid. And the ringleaders of Shays' Rebellion were, of course, captured. They were hanged. And, of course, the capital was moved to Washington, D.C., District of Columbia, named after another mass murderer, Christopher Columbus. Now, what is so important about the movement of the capital to this, 60 square miles of swampland or whatever that became essentially a sewer? Basically, the District of Columbia is not subject to posse comitatus. What does that mean? That means that they can kill you anytime they want because they can, because their government, it's not subject to the laws of the United States. Now, listen carefully to what I'm saying before you ever take children on a field trip to Washington, District of Columbia, before you ever decide to visit yourself as a tourist, keep this in mind. Anytime they want, someone in Washington, D.C., who is an officer or an agent of the law, everyone from a policeman to a federal agent to a politician, has the right to take out a firearm and blow your brains out. Blow your brains out of your wife, out of your children. They could kill every single one of them, and they will face absolutely no legal consequences because there's no posse comitatus in effect in Washington, D.C. Now, this was carried out against the veterans after World War I. Who, guess what? They didn't get paid. So after World War I, the American Expeditionary Forces came back home. They weren't paid. And they were told they weren't going to be paid until 100 years later. And so they marched on Washington, D.C. And they said, we're going to stay camped out on Anacostia Flats. We're going to march in front of the White House until we get paid. So, of course, President Hoover had a solution. He had them all killed. He marched out the biggest scumbags in American military history, George S. Patton, General Douglas MacArthur, General Eisenhower. And of course, Eisenhower was an assistant to General MacArthur at that time, who was in charge, of course, of pretty much the entire military. And you had, of course, General Patton, who at that time was not yet a general, but a young officer rising up in the ranks. And these three scumbags murdered their fellow servicemen because they were commissioned. They were always going to get paid. And they killed the people who didn't get paid. As a matter of fact, they used poison gas left over from World War I. They set the shanty town in which the veterans were camped out on across Anacostia Flats on fire. They came in with cavalry. And I don't know if you've ever seen a pregnant horse kicking a woman, but I had to burn photographs of such. And, they were basically trampling over women and children. And, of course, they killed a number of them. All of this was covered up by the government. And, of course, the gas was so powerful, being left over World War I, chemical agents, that it forced many pregnant women to miscarry. So they aborted many babies through involuntary assault. And it goes on and on. But basically, you've got a situation where that's Washington, D.C. for you. That's why they set it up the way they did, so that other veterans who marched and demanded to be paid, they could simply kill them. And then, of course, they've extended that to everyone. They can kill anyone they want who goes to Washington, D.C. So unless you're a fool, you have no business going to Washington, D.C. The laws do not apply there. That would apply anywhere else in any state, because it's not a state. It is its own kingdom within a state within a state, a kingdom within a kingdom. So you know what to avoid now, both the military going to Washington, D.C., and ultimately you might have some idea of why your nation is not even worth fighting for, why you have no sane reason to fight for this nation, nor to admire its founding fathers. As a matter of fact, to put this in some perspective, because I myself was born in the Nationalist Republic of China, as reestablished onto the island of Taiwan, obviously my first language was Chinese. There is no traditional word in Chinese for quote-unquote independence. There's no traditional word in Japanese for privacy. There are new terms. There are modern terms that have been introduced that get, of course, Japanized or Sinified for such concepts, but they're not a normal part of those cultures, which have lasted for thousands of years. Now, therefore, when you take the Declaration of Independence as written by the Founding Fathers, and the Chinese try to interpret it into their language, try to translate it or transliterate it as accurately or as literally as possible, they get a very telling translation. The closest concept in a Chinese iconograph or a pictograph, which would be like a character, as it's also called, there's their language, which is written, of course, in symbolic language as opposed to letters. The closest iconograph or pictogram that they have as a character to a concept of independence would be a criminal mindset. It would be something similar to conveying F everybody, every man for himself. So when the Declaration of Independence is translated into Chinese, it is translated as a criminal contract in which a bunch of criminals got together and basically decided to codify the concept of F everybody, every man for themselves. Now, that's an accurate translation as far as I'm concerned. That would be the true spirit of your Declaration of Independence, which, by the way, if you understood the Founding Fathers and the history behind that declaration, they basically originally phrased it life, liberty, and the pursuit of property. And that's when they ran across the problem. They said, wait a second, we're going to be fighting the Brits. We got to take all of these peasants who are working our land, living off of nothing but the food that they're growing, our white slaves. How do we get our white slaves to fight for us? Well, they had to change it from life, liberty, and the pursuit of property to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And that way, of course, their troops could, since they're never going to get paid, at least be fighting for happiness. Now, all of this becomes incredibly, hysterically, tragically comedic. This is insane. It's insanity. And, of course, it didn't last, which is why there was almost a rebellion of a proletarian sort to destroy the victorious conservative revolution, which had won out in the original establishment of the American Republic, which now we suffer in. Now, inside of this American Republic, you are faced with a question, of course, that you brought up as to, okay, you're saying we're run by the military. How did that happen? How did we get to that point? And that, of course, is from the American Civil War between the states. Around that period of time, you had the southern states of the United States fighting for independence. Militarily, they were overwhelmed by the industry of the North. And this was because the American Civil War between the states was a railroad war. It was a war of industry. Now, people might argue that and say, well, the South was agricultural. The South, of course, had a cotton economy of exportation. They had, of course, slaves, and the African-American population far, far exceeded the master population of whites in the Deep South. And, of course, the problem was that they had to transport this cotton, the slaves, etc., so they were industrializing at least to the level where they could manufacture their weapons, etc., and as a result, of course, they had rails. So, every major battle, people can look this up, within the American Civil War between the states, undeniably took place within 20 miles of track. It had to, because there's no other way to transport that amount of supplies, that amount of manpower, that amount of personnel, etc. So logistically, you had a railroad war, every major battle taking place within 20 miles of track. The end result was they were overwhelmed by the rail robber barons of the industrial North, and the rail robber barons said, this war has been so profitable, this war has been so great for our economy, we can't have it stop. And the same with the Union officers. The Union officers, of course, made a killing, both literal and financial, by looting southern masses and estates, stealing everything from fine china to furniture, putting it on the market, making themselves rich, making themselves a killing as the criminals that they were as commissioned officers. And as a result, they said, yeah, let's get together and we'll take over the country if the elections don't work our way. So an election was held. And get this, this is right after you had a Republican president who was so tyrannical, who was so maniacal, so insane that when anyone tried to stand up against him, he suspended habeas corpus so he could put them in jail. So you had thousands of people in jail, literally, to the day that a Confederate soldier blew out the brains of Abraham Lincoln. And habeas corpus came back into effect so they could release these people after that tyrant, after that unconstitutional dictator had been killed. Now, this is really important. He wasn't voted out of office. He wasn't put on trial for treason. He wasn't impeached. He was killed. And after he was killed in cold blood, the American people got together and elected a Democrat. Now, what's so incredible about this? Because back in those days, the Democrats were the party of the Solid South. Most of the people who were in prison under suspension of habeas corpus under the Abraham Lincoln dictatorship were Democrats. And yet, when this guy is killed, not voted out, not impeached, the guy gets killed, what do the American people vote in? A Democrat. This really needs to tell you something. If you don't understand this, you don't understand the American Civil War between the states, because the Democrats were known as Dixiecrats. So this is how disgusted the American people were, North and South. They voted in a party member of the South. Now, who was this individual? Who was your 19th president? He was Samuel Tilden. And Samuel Tilden won by a majority in both the popular and the electoral vote. He won by about a dozen, maybe more, 13, 14 electoral votes, which is an enormous amount. That's the majority of the states he carried. And, of course, he won the vote of the popular people. Millions of people voted for him. This really shows you how bad the war went for the Union and the Republic and how it was defeated morally, if not militarily. And so Samuel Tilden, how come we never hear of him? What ticket did he run on? He ran on a Ralph Nader platform. Corruption, fighting the corruption of the military-industrial complex, the corporate machine which employed generals who were commissioned officers, shareholders, people who owned stock in the Incorporated States of America, who ran a war of extermination against the Southern peoples, and were going to institute a campaign of deportation of the African-American peoples. So these evil scumbags who represented the North, who represented Union, who represented your Republic, as personified by the Republican Party underneath the leadership of a madman known as Abraham Lincoln, these people essentially were voted out. And they brought in Samuel Tilden because he was campaigning against corporate and military corruption. Now, did he stay in power? Of course not. They stole the election. They stole the election by basically sending a bunch of thugs, hired mercenaries, down into the southern states, particularly Florida and Louisiana, beating people up who entered the voting lodges and were going in there, since the votes had already been conducted, to count and ratify the votes by threat and by bribery. All of this, by the way, is entirely vetable. People can do research on this themselves. They can confirm what I'm saying. It is undeniable. It's incontrovertible. They stole the election. So by stealing the election by violence, by fraud, by not counting votes that were turned in, by manipulation of the electoral, they stole the presidency by one single vote, one single electoral vote. So they put in a general. General Rutherford B. Hayes. So this was a gorilla in a suit who was famous for beating his own men to death on the field of battle. And Rutherford B. Hayes, of course, basically knew what he had done was entirely illegal. It was done wide open in the sunlight with no finesse whatsoever. And of course, by not bothering to hide it, he had to come to a concession with the South, because the South was going to rise up and revolt again. And of course, the Civil War would be lost. So he said, let's institute the Great Compromise of 1877. So the Great Compromise of 1877 was established, in which the Klan took over the South, gerrymandered all of the districts so that the African-American vote, which would otherwise be far in the majority, was peripheralized and were able to maintain for decades their way of life. So one can certainly argue, if they did not militarily win the war, they certainly won the peace. And as a result, the South maintained a cultural continuity for decades. When people think of the South and the culture of the South, they think Dukes of Hazzard, they think Elvis, they think Clinton, they think a series of really rotten presidents that are kind of like the Dixie's version of the Montezuma's Revenge Syndrome. And this political diarrhea is always in the form of white people. People have not thought of the culture of the South in black terms very much to this point in history because of that white monopoly on the culture of the South for quite some period of time. Obviously, in that sense, they prevented cultural genocide as they saw their culture underneath the quote-unquote rebel flag, which only recently has come into question again. And of course, we've gone through the politics of that fairly recently. Ironically enough, of course, the Klan flag being from the time of William Gamaliel Harding, himself a Klansman, being the American flag, not the Confederate States flag. It was the American flag during all of the Klan marches in Washington, D.C. It was the American flag as the Klan expanded to its highest numbers in the days of Warren Gamaliel Harding in the 1920s. So we have a situation in which the Union flag has been identified as the Klan flag for quite some time now, at any rate, and has nothing to do with the Confederate States flag, just so that people out there know. The ignorance in which they vote, the ignorance on which they act. And, of course, that brings us back to exactly what happened with the theft of the presidency. You had, at that point, the military-industrial complex of the rail robber barons, and the U.S. military run a pirate flag up over both of the United and Confederate States of America and proceed its expansion of genocide into the High Plains, where it stole unincorporated territories from the Native Americans, the first indigenous peoples, and, of course, proceeded to expand these rails all the way to the Pacific. That would ultimately lead to the greater Pacific conflict of the Second World War in terms of their aggressive expansion. So with this president-elect and the rulership of the military from that point in time, how did the military retain its power? How did it get all of its money? Why didn't anyone ever vote it out? How does it get Congress to cooperate? So that brings us ultimately to what leads to men like Colonel Michael Aquino. Basically, they instituted a way to blackmail the political establishment that supposedly represents you and I, the taxpaying electorate. They said, oh, okay, now we've got this false president select. We've got our genocide going. We're expanding to the Pacific where we're going to launch another series of wars. We're going to try and conquer planet Earth. It's not enough, of course, that we stick with stealing the North American continent. We're going to try and take over the world. Now, this, of course, was stated by Mr. Harriman, who was the president of Union Pacific, who wanted to establish a worldwide rail line dominated by American shareholders. This would be a railroad line that would go all the way through Alaska over the Bering Strait on a bridge rail link that would lead into Siberia, into Manchuria, and connect America by rail over an overland route all the way from San Diego to basically Manchuria and through into Tokyo. Now, how is that possible? Well, Tokyo and the Korean Peninsula are very close to each other. They're so close to each other that if you're drinking a beer on a beach in Japan and you throw it into the sea, not that I advise you to do that, it'll wash up on a Korean beach. The same thing happens in Korea. You're drinking a soda pop on the Korean Peninsula, you throw it into the sea, it's going to wash up on a Japanese beach. That's how close they are. A healthy Olympian could swim the distance, just as healthy men and Olympians have swum the English Channel. You could build a bridge over it quite easily. The only thing that's prevented that all of these years has been politics. Now, of course, the Koreans and the Japanese were a single nation for a fairly long period of time in the modern age, and a lot of that is due to American involvement. The Americans, of course, invaded Korea. They invaded Korea very shortly after the American Civil War between the states. And their purpose was to establish a rail link between Korea and Tokyo, which was industrializing, going through its own industrial revolution. American mercenaries were helping the imperial forces to defeat the samurai, which had ruled for generations. This is portrayed fairly well and fairly accurately in the movie The Last Samurai, starring Tom Cruise. American investiture in this Japanese Civil War was on the imperial side to gain a government which was not resistant to Western industrialization or Western investment. And, of course, the intent was to establish a rail link from Tokyo through Korea into Manchuria, overland into Siberia, over into Alaska, through the North American continent to connect the economies. In that sense, Tokyo would be physically linked to the North American continent. All of this is a plan for world domination, which led to the greater Pacific conflict during the Second World War. So you can blame all of this on the stolen election that put General Rutherford B. Hayes into the executive office by the theft of one single electoral vote. Think of the catastrophe that I've just described. All of this should resonate. Now it gets worse. How do they maintain Congress to continue to vote for these military appropriations of so much funding, endless amounts of funding, all of your tax dollars for all intents and purposes, all of your discretionary income? Every single year, Congress is faced with a budget choice. Now, what do we do? What do we vote for? Do we vote for health care? Do we vote for care for the seniors? Do we vote for veterans' benefits who served in the military? Do we vote for education? Do we vote for children? No, of course not. It all goes to the military every single year. Well over 50% of your discretionary income goes to the military. 51 to 57% or more. It's never less than 50%. It's always over half. Now, how does this happen? Why would they do this? What comes from your military? What productivity comes from your military? Of course, nothing. Nothing comes from your military. There's nothing that comes of it. It certainly doesn't provide you with a growth industry. It doesn't provide you with jobs. It's a very incestuous economy that maintains itself. It maintains itself. Now, what happens with all of this military on a day like this, with the day that we're conducting this pre-recorded interview? It's going to be uploaded. It's going to be published onto YouTube within about 72 hours. And by that time, it'll be about September, I guess about 12th or 13th when this goes up on YouTube. Right now, it's September 10th. It is the eve day of the Memorial Day of September 11th. Now, of course, we have to ask ourselves, well, what does that represent? Well, that represents the culmination of a lot of American aggression, of a lot of American military adventurism overseas, in which they killed many innocent people and alienated all kinds of otherwise what would be friendly populations and turned them into blood enemies. That's what they did in Korea, basically in 1866, exactly 100 years before I was born, myself, in the year 1966, you had the American ship named the General Sherman. Now, think of what I'm talking about. General Sherman was a genocidal general who led Sherman's march into the Deep South, purposefully setting entire granaries on fire to burn the food supply so that the Confederates would starve in the winter, to burn the cotton supply so that the Confederates would have no clothing through the winter. This was genocidal action, and his response, of course, to accusations of genocide from foreign observers was, war is hell. Well, such is something that he wanted to bring to the rest of the world, and they did so. So 100 years before I was born, back in 1866, the USS General Sherman ignored demands from the Korean Navy to turn back. And the USS General Sherman took Korean civilians hostage, and they set fire to civilian villages, and they proceeded up the rivers into Korea until finally, thank God, they were surrounded on both sides of a riverbank, and the entire crew was killed and the Korean hostages freed. Now, what do we call this today? We call it terrorism. So this is what your military did in Korea. How did the Americans respond? They responded by basically going to Japan, asking for porting rights, some basing rights, paid the Japanese so that they could invade Korea from Japan. So in 1871, the United States invaded Korea. Now think about what I'm saying. 1871, the United States invaded Korea with 700 Marines and naval infantry, and they basically destroyed the Korean royal family, took over the capital, forced trade protection status on the Kingdom of Korea, and made it a colony of the United States. The Americans are still there today. Do you know any of this? No, of course not. No one ever educated you. How did you get there? How did you get in Korea today? Why are there Americans in Korea? I'm telling you how it happened. That's how it happened. And so, of course, the Koreans hate Americans. And, of course, who was put in charge of Korea? It was a scumbag named Durham White Stevens. In 1883, he resigned his post as the American legation in Tokyo under executive orders and entered the Japanese diplomatic corps to serve as the secretary to the Japanese legation in Washington, D.C. That's so he could learn the language. And then he was established as Japan's representative in Korea the next year. And ultimately, he became the American dictator of Korea. Now, how do I know so much about this scumbag? Because the Koreans came to the United States to kill his rotted ass. They assassinated him right here in San Francisco, where I live, and they assassinated him in front of the ferry building of San Francisco. So when they assassinated him and took his ass out, his reputation was so negative for all the genocide he had conducted in Korea that when he was taken out by the Koreans, he was known via the headlines of the New York Times, the Gray Lady itself, as the American dictator of Korea. But you never heard of this guy. You've never learned about him. You never learned what you're doing in Korea. And so how did this scumbag and his death impact the world even further? Well, the assassination was so successful. One of the assassins escaped. The other assassin was put in jail, and he was released about 10 years later or something like that, right after World War I. And he was welcomed home in Korea as a national hero. Now try and consider this. Have you ever heard of this national hero in Korea who took out the American dictator of Korea right here in San Francisco? No, of course you didn't. But that assassination was responsible for the assassination of your president. It served as the model. Well, what president? I've never heard of this. What are you talking about? Well, what happened was the Americans, of course, had the Spanish-American War. And when they conducted the Spanish-American War, they conducted it in the Caribbean. They conducted it in Asia. This was a world war. They fought the Spanish Empire, which had been one of the greatest empires on Earth, which had established a Pax Hispaniensis, a peace of Spain that stretched all across the globe. And it was senescent. It was entering economic depression, but it held a large part of the world. The Philippines is one of the largest archipelagos in the world. It's well over 7,100 islands. And of course, what happened was after Durham White Stevens was established as the dictator in Korea back in 1884, the Americans said, well, we'll take the rest of Asia too. They said, let's take the Philippines from the Hispanics. And basically, they declared war. And basically, under President Benjamin Harrison, the war was started in 1889. And they invaded the 7,100 islands of the Philippines. And the general in charge of that expedition was a General Jacob W. Smith. And he gave orders for United States troops to take no prisoners. He said, I want all persons killed who are capable of even lifting a gun. That means I want everybody killed who's over the age of 10. I want them dead, men, women, and children. Anyone over the age of 10 is an enemy combatant and to be exterminated. And that's led to the longest guerrilla war in history, one of the longest. Basically, it when the Catholic North, the Americans killed 60,000 people, not in combat, not in combat. They took out 60,000 people and killed them in on-the-spot summary executions, on-the-spot summary executions. 200,000 were later on killed in combat when the Filipinos started to fight back. 2 million people were left homeless, and it got worse. When they headed into the south of the Philippines, they ran into the Muslims, and the Muslims weren't going to take any of their shit. So they finally exterminated them, entire villages, and killed 3 million of them. Now think about what I'm saying, because both Korea and the Philippines border Japan. Now, when Japan incorporated Taiwan in 1895, the island on which I was born, they gained a maritime boundary with the Philippines. Their boundary with Korea is so close that for a period of time, they were one single nation. Now imagine if the Japanese had invaded Canada and established a dictator in Canada, and then invaded Mexico and proceeded to slaughter millions of Mexicans. How would Americans feel? They'd say, this is crazy. We've got to fight back. That's what led to your Second World War. The Japanese would have been criminally negligent not to prepare for war against the United States and fighting back. Obviously, you wanted to conquer Asia and the world, and as a result, they had to fight back. If you think otherwise, you're insane. If the Japanese had done the same to you and you didn't fight back, you would be insane. So what happened, of course, prior to the Second World War was your President McKinley came into office. He held the largest banquet and party that had ever been held in recorded history. Hundreds of industrialists, hundreds of people came in during his inauguration as your president, resulted the war in the Philippines because they were going to basically launch a campaign to kill all of the Filipinos and repopulate the Philippines with American, European American, white American, Caucasian colonists. And so this campaign was begun with the largest party on earth to usher it in, the largest party in recorded human history. And very shortly thereafter, on September 11th, in 1901, a Filipino came into the United States and modeling his assassination after the assassination that the Koreans had taken out against Durham White Stevens, modeled his very firearm into a cast showing his weapon only as a projectile barrel that was hidden within the cast of a supposedly broken arm, exactly the way the Korean assassins had approached Durham White Stevens. That's how they blew him away. That was the very model for which a Filipino named Leon Czolgosz came into the United States and used the same assassination technique to blow away President William McKinley on September 11th, 1901, 100 years to the day before September 11th in 2001. Now think about what I'm saying.
Well, let me jump in here real quick, Douglas, because what you're describing seems to me as if these events take place in such synchronicity that there is a major influence behind the scenes orchestrating things to take place at certain days, times of day, etc. Do you think that these people that create these enormous events have help behind the scenes with what many might call demonic or dark forces?
I appreciate that question. And in this case, I would say that there is not a demonic influence. I would say that this is almost an angelic influence of karma. really, the Americans did everything they could to hide this. If you look this up on Wikipedia, which is the bathroom wall of information intercourse, keep in mind, it's important to remember the average person who is trying to look for information on their own is lost. They're at a loss because everything that you get in terms of your information really, truly, for the overwhelming majority, other than by accident, sources out of DARPA. All of the internet was originally created by the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency. Very little appears on the internet that is not leaked by them. To give you some perspective on this, your internet is the slowest in the world next to communist China's. The only internet slower than the American internet is communist China's. North Korea, of course, doesn't even have an internet. North Korea has very limited networks that are in office, so to speak, between different facilities or organizations of the state that communicate only with each other and do not have access to anything outside of their particular network. So they have, in communist China, what would be considered a fairly liberal, progressive, and freely run network system, except for the fact that, of course, it's monitored by thousands and thousands of bureaucrats. And because it goes through these bureaucrats, if you're in the United States and you're accessing communist Chinese internet, which I've done, you're waiting until the cobwebs grow before what you're looking for reaches you across the Pacific. It's not even worth the intercourse. It's not even worth the interaction, which is one thing that keeps China pretty separate by an electronic firewall from Western decadence. Now, believe it or not, you go to the United States across the Pacific, and it's not much better. The internet here, compared to Japan, compared to Europe, is the slowest in the world, other than the examples that I've just given. And the reason why is it all goes through Predator. It all goes through these various other kinds of programs that are looking supposedly for child pornography. Now, where does all this child pornography fit in? How is this such a factor in terms of what we're contending with on the net? Well, that goes back to DeltaNet. Basically, what happened was the United States military, under DARPA's lead, produced, of course, what we called DARPANET, which was not released to the American public until a decade after its development. And, of course, the Army prior to that had its own internet system. It was an in-system network, very similar to what they got in North Korea, and only for other people to look at within the military. So this was organized by Task Force Delta. This has nothing to do with Chuck Norris or Lee Marvin or the movie Delta Force. Okay, Delta Force was, of course, a genuine anti-terrorist or counter-terrorist operational unit. It is still with us. Delta Force is a group of men who are, of course, are an elite unit that was tragically misdeployed in the rescue of the Iranian hostages under the Carter regime. But what happened was that you've got a Task Force Delta that was organized involving Colonel Michael Aquino in the aftermath of the Vietnam War, when, of course, they had to eliminate the draft and then had to try and get people to volunteer. They couldn't draft people anymore. So what happened was they got this Task Force Delta together to think of a way to get people to be stupid enough to sacrifice all freedom and join a military where they'd be experimented on and massacred and killed and tortured basically to death and then left penniless. So they got together an army think tank of officers, futurists, psychologists, and they studied the potential of new technologies to solve the Army's critical personnel problems. And basically, the person who was part of this was Lieutenant Colonel James Channon, who was, of course, a co-religionist of Michael Aquino. Now, Lieutenant Colonel James Channon is portrayed in the film The Men Who Stare at Goats as this lovable scumbag who's like this hippie freak passing out flowers to other officers.
George
Clooney? No. No, George Clooney portrays General Vallely. General Vallely is another co-religionist of Michael Aquino.
Oh, Jeff
who's
Bridges.
The man? I believe so, yeah, okay. I believe okay. so. Yeah, so if you see the wild-eyed, psychotic hippie who's running around giving flowers to other officers, he's not the general. The general is George Clooney. George Clooney portrays a general, if I remember correctly, in that film, which I've never watched, by the way, but I know of and I know the constituents of it. George Clooney portrays the general who is the analog of General Vallely, who was responsible for organizing ISIS, which is on the loose in the Southwest Asia, of course, killing people, mass murdering, destroying historical artifacts. It's responsible for both human and cultural genocide. And, of course, one of the people responsible for organizing it was your military, personalized under the one of its main movers and shakers in that particular operation, General Vallely, who's portrayed as this lovable curmudgeon, kind of wide-eyed, starry-eyed fellow in The Men Who Stare at Goats. All these men are portrayed in this charismatic, lovable, likable fashion. Okay, none of that has has anything to do with reality. So the other guy played by the Bridges character that you just mentioned, or the actor who portrays the character, who's the analog of Lieutenant Colonel James Shannon at the time that he was doing all this damage, is, of course, the villain in your world, who's portrayed as this lovable, laughable, comedic character in the world of fantasy in which you live, in which you've retreated to as a population. Now, in terms of James Shannon, he, of course, ran the 1st Earth Battalion, whose entire motto is men who dare to think the unthinkable and do the undoable, meaning they were willing to think and do anything that you would never do if you're constrained by any moral fabric. And so what these people organized was a Delta Net. And Delta Net was, of course, basically a kind of army communication system which had its own electronic mail. It was a prototype of the internet, and it was infamous for child pornography. It carried enormous amounts of it because many people in the United States military are into pedophilia. So you've got this because that's how they blackmail your government. How do you get all of these politicians in Congress to constantly vote over such massively irrational, entirely unproductive, and auto-destructive, economically depressing amounts of money to a military which has proven itself again and again corrupt, incompetent, irresponsible, and the primary villain on the world scene. So basically, you get them to do this because they're blackmailed. Now, how are they blackmailed? What happened was the McMartin preschool scandal, many other scandals concerning child molestation. We had a home for boys in Florida that a book has been written about called The White House Boys, because these boys were, of course, in this juvenile delinquents rehabilitation center, prostituted out as quote-unquote queer whores to the White House. Now, all of these people were, of course, murdered. They found mass graves. Hundreds of them were murdered. We may never know how many people were murdered, but the graves we've discovered have been shocking enough. People can see images of these mass graves and the exhumation of these boys if they look up the White House Boys and the Florida rehabilitation school for children that resulted in these horrible mass murders and ritual sacrifices. Now, all of this, of course, is true. And when you get back to, say, for instance, the McMartin preschool scandal, there was a mother whose child was terribly affected by that molestation that took place there. And she basically was friends with a friend of mine, a private investigator, a detective by the name of Edward Opperman. Edward Opperman, of course, was someone who basically was investigating a lot of this kind of phenomenon. And she told him, of course, that another man supposedly investigating it, whose name was Ted Gunderson, an agent for the FBI, who's seen on an interview on Geraldo Rivera, sitting right next to Colonel Michael Aquino. Both of them, without batting an eye, are seeming to feel any revulsion towards each other. And this guy's viewed as a hero in alternative media. This guy's viewed as someone who's helping kids. And the first thing this mother told Ed Opperman, this private investigator I know, was, you know, I was intimate with Ted Gunderson. And when we'd wake up in bed together every morning, the first thing he'd do would be to call Colonel Michael Aquino for instructions. So the fix is totally in. And by the way, I do want to give a shout out here to people because of my website no longer existing because of my firing my manageress. I do want to give a shout out here because we were talking about a photograph that proclaims to show Michael Aquino with Bush Sr. and William Jefferson Clinton. That photograph is a real photograph. It's in no way photoshopped. Whether or not that's Michael Aquino is open to question. I do not think it is Michael Aquino. Having worked with the man for nigh a decade, in no way, shape, or form really looks like him. And I do know for a fact that there's a hoax photograph concerning Anton Zandor LaVey. And Anton LaVey, of course, is shaking hands with Senator John Kerry. Now, that is a hoaxed photograph. Okay, that's not real. And this photograph is a real photograph, but it's not Michael Aquino. So do keep a lookout for misrepresentations. I know about that photograph because it was originally relayed to myself by Cara Mastry, a delightful young lady. I want to give a shout out to her. I want to give a shout out for the Tawn Mastry Foundation. And the Tawn Mastry Foundation deals with her sister who died of hepatitis. So her sister was an entertainer and someone who was very much working with the entertainment industry, who contracted hepatitis that ultimately led to her death. And so do check out on Facebook the Tawn Mastry Foundation. I'll give you the Facebook of my own to also check out. And say hello, if you can, to Kara Mastery as well. Amidst all of this ugliness, there are, of course, people who are attempting to do good in the world and bring awareness to conditions that could ultimately impact us all if we're not careful. And certainly hepatitis is definitely one of them. In the case of my own contact, best to do so through my Executrix producer, Laura Lee Solomon, on Facebook. Want to remind people to check out my own Facebook timeline. My public community fan page is facebook.com/Douglas Dwayne Dietrich. Douglas is spelled with one S. Dwayne is spelled D-U-A-N-E. Dietrich is spelled just by putting the words diet and rich together. D-I-E-T-R-I-C-H. I used to basically use the name, of course, of my distant relation, Marlena Dietrich, who was indeed born a Dietrich. There are stupid people out there who say otherwise. They're absolute fools. They have no knowledge of her genealogy. Her name was indeed Dietrich. She is a relation. You can even see the physical similarity if you compare my videos and her photographs. It's hardly something that's really contestable. But the point is that Marlena Dietrich is no longer well known to new generations of people, which is very sad. So the stars are indeed fading in the sky, and generations are growing up in darkness. From days when Hollywood was truly glamorous to what we have today, producing crap like The Men Who Stare at Goats. So in terms of what I am bringing up, also, if you go to the public community fan page, put a like on it so that I'm not required to pay for it. That keeps me from having to pay to maintain it. So long as it gathers enough likes, please go there and do that. You can also Facebook friend me, going to facebook.com/DouglasDDietrich, and contact Laura Lee Solomon. Not many people with that name, so it should be easy to find her on Facebook. And Skype friend her at Laura Lee Solomon as her Skype ID. So that can help communicate with myself in the future, and it can help to basically try and arrange for my appearances or my speaking in any venue that you might be thinking of that you might want to sponsor. So once again, Laura Lee Solomon is spelled LauraLeeSolomon. And Laura Lee Solomon is, of course, my executrix producer at Revolution Radio, where I have my own program on Tuesday nights. The topical Tuesdays are named Critical Omissions, and I'm on from 10 to midnight Eastern Time. And I'm also on 10 to midnight Eastern Time on Saturday Night Firing Lines, where I personally will take all of your calls. Do feel free to call in, Skype in primarily. Again, Skype friend Laura Lee Solomon, using her name as her Skype ID prior to transmission. We can bring you in on the show. And when you Skype in during transmission, Skype friend or prior, we'll bring you in when you Skype in during the show. And then you can ask me anything you want, including about the topics we're covering tonight. Also, remember, of course, we are talking in front of hundreds of thousands of people. Do maintain respect and civility towards the staff, towards myself. We do have to put you off air if you use any kind of slurs, whether it's ethnic, religious, or gender orientation or sexual orientation slurs or defamations. We also cannot let you on air, obviously, if you threaten any lawsuits. But otherwise, we take any questions that you decide to field, any challenges that you might have, present it in a respectful and constructive manner. So definitely, again, you have to avoid the use of legal terminology, threat of litigation, or for reasons of the station, you have to be bumped off air. Now, it's incredibly important to bring that up with people because people never learn, sadly, and they really have no concept of what they're getting into when they bring up such terminology on air. But other than that, Saturday Night Firing Lines, I take your calls, and Tuesday, I pretty much try and tell people about the subjects like we're covering tonight, which is just what one of many subjects that I cover. Both nights, I'm on 10 to midnight, and I want to thank, of course, our good friend, Mr. Rex Bear, for allowing me to bring that up.
Absolutely. People need to know how to get in contact with you. And earlier in this podcast, we were discussing the founding fathers of America and their connections with Freemasonry. The picture that you paint describes a very dark, nefarious organization that is hell-bent on creating this anti-God because of deism. I know several Master Masons and a 32nd degree Freemason that seem like everyday people that have absolutely nothing to do with a global conspiracy. But do you feel that these founding fathers were actually connected with the Antichrist, as many Christians would call him, or these dark demonic entities?
Well, I appreciate you bringing that up, and I want to go there. Then I want to go back to the net and exactly how that applies to what we're dealing with today. But it's important to bring up the Freemasons. Now, the first question I would have in return, not that I want to overdwell on it, is the Freemasons that you have nothing against, which I'm not saying that people should go out and do damage to Freemason property or Masonic lodges or do anything that would result in any harm to practicing Freemasons. Obviously, the first thing that I do need to say to reinforce what you're saying is that there are Masons and there are Masons. I mean, they're basically people who join the organization, and the majority of people who join the organization are going to learn absolutely nothing in terms of any mysteries of life. They're not going to get anything other than a lot of really boring meetings and really humdrum kind of social intercourse and networking that many people would find really useless. There, a great example of this was a clown I once knew who had been in the military, who was a non-commissioned officer who happened to be a Freemason, and of course he tried to apply for a job at the post office and wound up screwing up royally. Post office had been giving out these hiring kind of opportunities where people could get onto a list. The list would take years before you were responded to. Then when they had a hiring search, then people would be brought in, and then ultimately they would go through a series of tests which would see if they could be brought into the post office. Now, this guy is a Freemason. There were no connections that helped him out when he screwed up. Basically, he took it far too casually. He got in, got this golden opportunity towards a job that is high-paying, comparatively speaking, fairly secure. Messed it up by the numbers. He didn't do what they told him to do, which was to practice parking the exact opposite of how you would normally park, because the post office doesn't park the way you park. They park exactly the opposite because they're delivering mail. They're going an entirely different route from the way you're parking. They're parking exactly the opposite from where the way you're taught to park. And of course, he didn't practice, and he wound up effing it up completely. So he had this job for one day, and of course, wanted to use his Freemasonic connections to get back into it. And of course, that didn't help him at all. So, you know, there's no magic connection of networking that helps your average Freemason in terms of maintaining any quality of life. So there's no point in joining. It's like the military. There's nothing good that's going to come of joining. So why join? It's meaningless. It's a waste of time. So you're not going to learn any secrets. The first secrets you'll learn, the overwhelming majority of you, is that there are no secrets. Okay, these are not the Masonic lodges of the founding fathers. Okay, that's an entirely different group of people. So I'm going to assume that the people you knew who were Freemasons were along the lines of the people that I was talking about, just ordinary people, where this happened to be kind of like almost an inheritance, where granddaddy was a Freemason, daddy was a Freemason, and I'm kind of like a Freemason. But really, it doesn't really go beyond that. That's kind of like where you got your impression of the Freemasons you were contending with, I'm assuming. Individuals that you know pretty much seem to fall along the lines of what I've just been describing. They're not people who are part of an international conspiracy that seems to be functioning with any degree of coherency. Right. And right. So what you've got, however, in the shape of the Founding Fathers was something very different that has carried on into the military. At this point, it's left that initial foundation of Masonry as it manifested with the conservative insurgency of the United States, of what was North America at the time, or Royal America on the Atlantic seaboard, which, of course, shared the continent with French America, Russian America, and Spanish America. So you had various European empires conflicting on the North American continent, and the Freemasons were simply the assholes who initiated a junta, a coup, in order to conserve their ability to enslave, their ability to acquire ever more property, and to gratify all of their demoniacal wishes towards a global empire. Now, all of this does deal with dark entities. All of this does deal with very dark magic, because these were the people who were talking about Masonic tradition that goes all the way back to what they claim was Atlantis. And in terms of the Atlantean tradition, their claim to fame is that they sank Atlantis. Their claim to fame amongst the mysteries of their initiate order is that they were initially the builders of the pyramids. The term masonry comes from stone masonry. Stone masonry is, of course, a Masonic technology. This is a technology that was maintained by guildsmanship. People might be familiar with medieval guilds of feudal Europe. You had people derive their names or their surnames, their family family names from their trade. There are people like Danny Glover, the African-American actor. Now, he probably got his name from a white slave owner who gave him the surname of Glover. Now, Glover, of course, comes from a feudal medievalist guild of people who manufactured gloves. Literally, they were glovers. Now, that's a very fine piece of leather work to make a glove to fit somebody's hand comfortably enough where it doesn't impede their ability to work. I don't know if you or anyone else out there, through gardening or through some kind of labor, was forced to work with gloves on. But if you've ever tried to do any serious work with gloves that are not crafted directly to your hand, you will find out just how difficult it can be. Leather is not like elastic or modern synthetic materials. People who could make a glove were so specialized, that was all they did with leather. There were other men who made leather armor, leather jerkins, leather clothing, but there were people who specifically made gloves. These were glovers. That was a medieval guild. So the stonemasons, the masons of centuries ago, claimed that they rose the pyramids in mathematical precision, and then they were contracted to raise the Gothic cathedrals throughout Europe. That they were different. These were people who were of a different religion or a mystery tradition that they claimed went back to Atlantis. So the churches they were building were not churches that they had any faith in. So you had the Christian Gothic churches, many of these cathedrals built by the public themselves. The public got together and helped in the building and the construction of many cathedrals throughout Europe. Also, there were other cathedrals that had hidden passages, that had cryptic tunnels that led from one place to another, escape routes, places to cache wealth or hoard treasure during the Viking raids, so that valuable works of knowledge would be preserved from raids by barbarians. Many of the people who were building these churches were stonemasons. Many of these stonemasons were part of Freemasonry. So this Freemasonry of technicians that claimed that they learned these secrets to help maintain a kind of civilization as represented a culture of the church, as represented by churchianity or Christendom at that time, these were people who were not Christians themselves. They claimed this tradition back to pagan heathen Egypt and before that to Atlantis. Their claim to fame being that they tried to usher in extra cosmic entities that were from outside of our universe that ultimately warped the fabric of space and time around them and led to the entropic or entropy being speeded up, entered in as a factor into otherwise an orderly physical cosmos, a cosmos of mechanical laws, which they violated by their entry into this dimension that resulted in the sinking of a continent or the disappearance of its culture, the devastation of its peoples, the destruction of all of its works. Now, there are different interpretations. These would, of course, be extra cosmic entities that were described or warned of by H.P. Lovecraft. Howard Phillips Lovecraft's own father was a Mason of the true tradition. By that, I mean he was a Mason of the stone Masonic tradition in the sense of Edward Leeds Gulman. Edward Leeds Gulman was, of course, the man responsible for building Coral Castle. He came out of Latvia, the same nation, which was later on attributed to be the nation in which the gypsy child was raised, who became the Marvel comic villain Dr. Doom. And Dr. Victor Von Doom, of course, is a fictitious character who's portrayed as a gypsy child who grew up in the nation of Latvia, but he was inspired by Edward Leeds Gulman. Edward Leeds Gulman came out of Latvia, and he was a man whose, again, family was of true Masonic origin, and he claimed he knew the secrets of the building of the pyramids. So his engineering achievement is indisputable. It exists before our eyes. It's physical manifestation of the fact he, as one singular, tuberculotic, sickly individual, could do things that entire teams of engineers could not do today. Now, this individual did it all himself, without any pulleys or levers or massive machines that anyone could see or know of, and he did it in the dark of night so no one could see what he was doing. Children who tried to spy on him in the middle of the night claimed that they saw him levitating huge blocks of coral. And of course, this fossilized coral was very dangerous material to work with, very abrasive, could skin a person alive if it fell beside him. And yet he was working with this and putting together structures which modern engineers would find an incredible challenge, if not impossible, to mimic today. And so there was an individual who proved he was of Masonic tradition. It was of a similar nature which H.P. Lovecraft's father came from, a senescent Masonic family, the tail end of which was dying, impoverished. His father became a traveling salesman, ultimately in his travels, copulating with a number of different women and contracting syphilis. His father was ultimately to die of tertiary syphilis, deformed, deranged, maddened, screaming out the names of the anti-gods, the old gods that exist outside our universe, created by our divinity. And the names were, of course, barbarous names that are not physically pronounceable by the human vocal cords. Sathagwa, Yog-Sothoth, the Cthulhu. The rest of these entities were named by his father as best able to be mimicked by the human vocal cords, and H.P. Lovecraft wrote of them, warned the general population of them, and of course succeeded in doing the opposite of what he was trying to do. He wound up creating a mass movement of followers of these anti-gods, and that was through the help of men like Michael Aquino. Michael Aquino, of course, was known as the founder of the Temple of Set, or Setho was his original name. If you ever look up the history of Colonel Michael Aquino, his esoteric name was Seth-O. He took his name, of course, from Sethan, the original name for Satan from the pre-Christian anti-god of Seth of Egypt, the god of plagues, the god of darkness, the god of violent outsiders and foreigners. Sethan was, of course, in great battle with Horus, the national divinity of the Egyptians. The place of their battle became known as Cairo. Its name transliterates as place of battle because in proto-historical times, Seth and Horus walked the earth, conducting battle with each other at that very place where Cairo stands today. And Sethan, this ancient Satan, this ancient pre-Christian diabolic god, anti-god, became the Satan, of course, of Christianity, and then became the god of the Temple of Set, or the god of the Satanists, the theistic Satanists. And, of course, the original name for Colonel Michael Aquino, esoterically, himself was Setho. And the O, the hyphenated O, is added to infer that he was a member of a brotherhood. That O would be at the name of men like L. Ron Hubbard when he joined various satanic lodges. That O was at the name of Aleister Crowley when he was involved with various covens. So we have this tradition, and Setho, of course, Colonel Michael Aquino, ultimately was someone who was responsible for unleashing the DARPANET upon the world. And when DARPANET was released upon the world at that time, as I said, it was simply the host for DeltaNet. DeltaNet, of course, was with Task Force Delta working with James Channon on trying to recruit fools and suckers into the military to be victimized. And when they were communicating with each other using DeltaNet, all the child porn you can imagine would flow. So much so that when it was released to the public, it created an entirely new phenomenon. Now, I'll give you an example of this. I dealt, of course, with the Presidio military base child molestation scandals. What I leaked ultimately resulted in the closure of the Presidio military base. The Presidio military base was employing thousands and thousands of people. It was the Sixth Army headquarters. It was the headquarters of the United States Sixth Army. It was the Western Defense Command Center. That means that it was responsible for the command militarily of 17 Western states, basically all of the frontier states of the Old West and the former territory, now the occupied state of Hawaii. All of this was included within the bailiwick, the administrative responsibilities of the Presidio military base. It was the most important military base in the United States outside of the Pentagon. So you've got this place to show you how important it was. That was the founding site for the United Nations. The United Nations was established on January 1st of 1942, 3 weeks and 3 days after Pearl Harbor, as an organization of war per Title 42 of the United Nations Charter. It was at war, of course, with the Axis. And, of course, it was responsible for coordinating all Allied resistance movements operating behind enemy lines in Axis-occupied territories from the Philippines all the way through to Denmark. It was coordinating them. This was the Pentagon of the United Nations. The offices of peace were opened in 1945. Those were the peace offices of the United Nations, the branch of war, the Pentagon of the United Nations, for its war operating procedures. And, of course, remember, that charter is still in effect. In lieu of a constitution, the United Nations has a charter. Title 42 of that United Nations charter defines it as an organization of war. This is why the United Nations runs peacekeeping operations using military forces all over the world today. The United Nations conflict on the Korean Peninsula in the 1950s was just that, a United Nations conflict. All American dead soldiers, sailors, Marines that died in the period of proactive hostilities from 1950 to 1953, that their bodies are still rotting on the Korean Peninsula whenever they're uncovered or discovered, they're sent home to the United States with their coffins draped under a United Nations flag. Not a United States flag, a United Nations flag. They were fighting for the United Nations, not the United States. Now, that's very important to remember because you're still there today under United Nations auspice. The Korean War is still legally on. The two Koreas are still legally at war, North and South Korea, across a demilitarized zone so massive it's the only other man-made object that can be seen from the moon aside from the Great Wall of China. Now, if you hear any idiot out there who says,
You can't see the Great Wall of China from the moon. WikiLeaks, tell me so.
And, you know, you can tell them how retarded that they are, because the astronauts have confirmed, without the use of telescopes, through their faceplates, they could clearly see the distinct outline of the Great Wall of China from the moon by its shadow. You can't see it from a plane, because when you're 20,000 feet in the air, China is the most industrialized nation on Earth, you fools, and it throws up particulate matter called air pollution. That's why when you're at 20,000 feet, since the Great Wall of China is made out of stone materials that are derived from the Earth around it, they weren't separate megalithic stones carried from continents away like Stonehenge. You have a wall which blends in visibly with the Earth. That's why you can't see it. You see it from space by its shadow. So wake up, grow up, and shut the F up, all these people who say the same stupid things over and over again. Now, the other thing you can see besides that wall from the moon is the demilitarized zone across Korea. That is how big that demilitarized zone is. It also serves as a preservation for Asian tigers and Asian cranes, several other kinds of animal species that would otherwise be extinct in the world today. You are still there under conditions of ceasefire in a war that you started when you invaded Korea after the American Civil War. Now, this is part of the horror of what I'm describing, but when we get back into what I'm trying to describe, aside from all this stonework and stonemasonry, we get back into exactly what was going on with the release of from the Presidio military base with that United Nations. This is another complaint I get. People say, United Nations was established as a peace organization in 1945. All you need to do is look up United Nations battle flag. If you look up the United Nations honor flag as they try to hide it under today's propaganda, that was the battle flag of World War II. You will find a white field that has four vertical stripes in red. That represents Roosevelt's, quote unquote, four freedoms. Now, Roosevelt's four freedoms were the cornerstone of the United Nations. And this white flag with four red stripes was made so that resistance fighters behind enemy lines could identify each other by taking a white shirt, a white sheet, a white surrender flag, and if American or British or Allied troops approach, they could identify themselves as UN resistance fighters by taking this and using their own blood, if necessary, to paint four vertical stripes very quickly so that they would not be identified as the Axis and not be shot. So if you look this up on the internet, United Nations battle flag, honor flag, you'll see it was in use throughout World War II, throughout the war years into 1948, because World War II did not legally end in the Pacific theater until 1952. The United States and the Empire of Japan were legally at war until April 28, 1952. So you see this actively in use by people in Asia on the Chinese mainland until 1948. You can look that up and confirm everything I'm saying. Now, this United Nations flag was, of course, important because the Japanese-American peace treaty was signed on site, the Presidio military base, on September 8, 1951. Just a few days ago, 64 years prior to September 8th, which just passed us a few days ago, that was the commemorative date for the Japanese-American peace treaty being signed, going into effect April 28th, 1952. And it was signed on September 8th, 1951. So that took place at the Presidio at the United Nations in Presidio, the Pentagon of the United Nations. Now, all this had to close. Thousands and thousands of people lost their jobs because of what I leaked as a whistleblower concerning all the child molestation ongoing at the Presidio military base, and much of this child pornography was on the DeltaNet. Now, this happened in the 1980s, the mid-1980s. Now, early on, when all of this really began to hit, when all of these kids were catching diseases, syphilis, hepatitis, gonorrhea, all these various sexual transmitted diseases, including AIDS, which at that point was a death sentence. My high school teacher, Gary Willard Hambright, was a ordained Baptist minister without a pulpit. And this Southern Baptist minister had no place to live. He was homeless. He lived in a church. He couldn't keep his child pornography in a church, so he kept it at the school that I attended, John H. O'Connell Vocational Institute. And I was majoring in commercial illustration. He was my instructor. He kept the child pornography on site, in the classroom, in the storage, as art references. Naked pictures of all kinds of kids in various sexual positions, being compromised physically in various juxtapositions with objects, animals, and humans. And all of this was art reference. He got away with that until I exposed the fact he maintained a collection of child pornography on San Francisco Unified School District property. And then, of course, he was arrested. He also was the manager for the child daycare center at the Presidio military base. He managed the CDC. By the time they arrested him, he had infected 500,000 children with AIDS. Now, this individual died of AIDS while he was on trial. And of course, the scandal was such, they took all the parents. This was in the days before the internet. So you would have heard all about it everywhere had there been an internet. There hadn't been an internet yet. It was not yet released for your perusal or your use. So they could hide it. They took all these military families who were victimized, and they basically transferred them to the four corners of the earth, because the U.S. military has bases all over the world. Okinawa, South Korea, Germany at the time, Latin America. They were transferred, but before they were transferred, they all got together and they burned the child daycare center to the ground. All of the records of this were kept at the community center, and the United States Army burned that to the ground to hide the evidence. Now, how do I know this? Because the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms came on base to investigate that arson, and they said, it's arson. This community center containing all these records was burned down by the U.S. Army. And the U.S. Army said, well, it's federal property. You're a federal agency. We're a branch of the United States government. You're on our property. We cry jurisdiction. And we say, it was accidental. And so it was hidden, the burning of that building. But if you do your research, you'll find out everything I say is true. And, of course, as a result of this, as a result of my whistleblowing, as a result of what I exposed, all of the Presidio military base had to be closed down. Thousands of people lost their jobs. And that means thousands of families went with their parents, going without work. And all these people want to see me burn. They all want to see me fry. So you got all kinds of people who hate my guts out there. But what was it that happened during that period of time that impacts you today? Aside from, say, for instance, the U.S. Army at that period of time. The U.S. Army at that period of time in the 1980s had daycare centers all over the world. Had them in Korea. Had them in Okinawa. Had them in Europe and in Latin America. Altogether, families were turning their kids into these rape centers like West Point, where, of course, all kinds of kids were complaining about people raping them, making them eat their own feces, making them drink their own urine, making them drink the urine of other adults or eat the feces of other adults. They brought in Rudy Giuliani to investigate it. Rudy Giuliani, Mr. 9/11, Mr. Hero. And Rudy Giuliani said, it's cool. All these kids are just having childhood fantasies because, you know, that's all what kids want. Kids want to eat other people's shit. Kids want to drink other people's piss because that's what kids do. So Rudy Giuliani said, there's nothing to investigate here. Go away. Look away. So he covered up all the crimes happening at West Point, where the Child Daycare Center building was numbered 666. Now, you've got this incident where finally one of these girls died, and she was about 2 years old. The sergeant who murdered her was released without spending a day in jail. And since it happened on the military base, on military property, he wasn't guilty because there's no civilian court in the world that could try him. It happened on federal military property, and the military said, it's cool. And they let him go, and he went back among you, totally free, without anything on his record. That's your military. You got John Stebbins, former U.S. Army Ranger, hero of Black Hawk Down. And they changed his name in the movie to Danny Grimes. Why? Because the real hero of Black Hawk Down was raping kids. And he was kidnapping them, taking them down to his basement, making them eat out of dog bowls, had them chained to the wall. And ultimately, his wife turned him in. And he went to federal military prison, where he stuck in the brig at Fort Bragg, North Carolina, I believe, if I'm not mistaken. But you can look up John Stebbins, see where he's kept in prison, just to confirm that. And he'll be there the rest of his life. Now, people have actually complained on YouTube. And they said, hey, this man was arrested for raping one child. How can you say he was raping all these other kids? No, he got arrested for raping one child. He raped many more before his wife turned him in, and they got him on that one crime, which he's serving time for. Just like my high school teacher, Gary Willard Hambright, died of AIDS while he was on trial. But before he died, he was indicted and convicted by a federal grand jury for sexual assault on 14 kids. Count them, 14. All of them infected by AIDS, who were all going to die, all of them under the age of 4. Now, that was all they were able to try and convict him for before he died of AIDS. If he had lived, he would have been convicted for hundreds. So these guys get convicted for one crime. They've done many more. Think of what you don't know about. Then I get people from the Army telling me, oh, but he committed those crimes while he was retired, referring to Sergeant Stebbins, the hero of Black Hawk Down. They said he committed these crimes before he was retired, after he was retired, so he wasn't part of the military. He's in a military prison, dudes. Why isn't he in a civilian prison with all the other baby raping sons of bitches? Why? What does that mean? It's a matter of life and death. It's totally important. It's pivotal. It means he was under military control. That means he committed all those rapes under orders. Do you get what I'm saying? Let me tell you something to back that up. During the 1980s, when this scandal was going down, we had federal law enforcement agencies in 1982 who didn't even consider child pornography a high priority because it was, quote unquote, vanishingly small. The supply was almost impossible to find. Now, in 1990, just before the military base of the Presidio closed down in 1992, around 1990 was when the library closed down where I served for almost a decade as a Department of Defense research librarian. And at that point in time, 1990, the National Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Children estimated that only 7,000 images of child pornography were even in circulation. Then the U.S. Army released the internet. And then the DeltaNet dumped all its child porn. And between 2006 and 2009, the United States Justice Department recorded 20 million unique computer IP addresses that were sharing child pornography files. Your army did this to you. And that's how they keep your politicians in control. Because they take these kids from places like these daycare centers that I'm describing, and they give them to politicians to screw and to F with. And then the politicians are photographed. And, of course, the politicians are at that point, from then on, voting for massive federal appropriations to defense contractors and your United States military for the rest of their careers. That's why all your money goes to the military. All based on this. Do you even get what I'm saying? I hope you do, because that's what runs your world. And your world is run by these diabolic entities, so diabolic that they made Lieutenant Colonel Michael Aquino, the man who organized the Temple of Set and avowed and open practicing Satanist, the official chaplain of the United States Army. That's why he wrote the Chaplain's Handbook. Don't take my word on it. Look it up. Who wrote the Chaplain's Handbook of the United States Army? Michael Aquino. And Michael Aquino wrote the Chaplain's Handbook of the United States Army so that every Jewish rabbi, every Catholic father, every Protestant priest, deacon, all these dudes had to step back and stand down and watch helplessly whenever a satanic priest stepped in to do his work. So they were all given the instructions of when to step back and stand down and shut up whenever a Satanist showed up in the Chaplain's Handbook. That's available on the net, folks. Look it up. United States Army Chaplain's Handbook, written by Michael Aquino. So, your official religion in your U.S. military is Satanism. This is what it's brought you. You want to exist. If you want to shape up, rehabilitate, have any hope for your future, dismantle your military. Your only protection from foreign invasion and social anarchy is your right to bear arms. So, make certain that you have a well-organized militia and an armed constabulary to prevent foreign invasion. You don't need the military because it's useless. 9/11 proved that. 9/11, conspiracy or not, your military insists it was done entirely by foreigners. So what are they telling you? They're telling you they can do absolutely nothing to prevent anything. You take a look at the situation in Rotherham in Scotland, in the United Kingdom. The British Empire, if you could still dignify it with that term, has a qualitatively superior military to the United States. It's got far better trained personnel. It's got special forces up the ass. It's got aircraft carriers. It's got nuclear submarines up at Holy Loch in Scotland that are bristling with intercontinental ballistic missiles. And what happens in Rotherham in Scotland? Southwest Asians, swarthy people wearing turbans, carrying the Quran, can walk around, pick whoever they want as a white girl to rape, rape her on the streets, and walk away laughing. This is not inflammatory rhetoric. This has happened for decades. People from Pakistan and Southwest Asia go on rape expeditions, safaris. They go to Rotherham in Scotland. They pick out white girls waiting at a bus stop. They rape them half to death and walk away laughing. And no one can do anything. It's the girl who gets arrested and she's threatened that if she doesn't keep her mouth shut, she's going to be burned alive. By the way, this is all, you can look this up. This happened and been reported countless times. Thousands and thousands of girls have been raped in Rotherham, Scotland. What does that military do to protect them? Nothing. All those carriers, all those special forces, all those nuclear submarines. Nothing. People can go there and rape whoever they want. Why? Because the British are helpless under their satanic military. That's you. The only thing that stops you from being Rotherham is the fact that you've got an armed populace.
that would start shooting if they saw that. They got gun control in England that they don't have here. The cops are unarmed in England. That's why when one man who was in the military was attacked by two black Muslims who cut his head off, the cops just stood back and told everybody, stay back, we're going to call people who do have guns. They're SWAT teams, which took hours to get there. Of course, the man was without a head at that point, and all everybody did was stand there and cry. That's what you would be like if you didn't have guns or an armed constabulary. So you make certain that no one takes that right away, and you make certain that you dismantle the very people who would take that right away, your military. That's what you've got to do. You want your children to have a future? You follow my advice. Otherwise, you're going to be stuck here with your children's children suffering the rulership of people like Giuliani, who you declared was a hero on the day that your military claims that they were entirely unable to prevent foreign invaders or invasion. Now, we go back to the Freemasons and the Illuminoids, their religion of Illuminism. And we say, well, these people, what were they doing that basically is so bad? Obviously, they claim they sank the continent of Atlantis. Oh, that sounds like a joke. At this point in history, what does that mean? Well, there was a man named Francis Bacon, a Freemason, who wrote the book The New Atlantis. And, of course, he placed it in the Pacific. Now, we have another man, of course, who colonized the New World, a new Atlantis, named Columbus, who started a genocide that has been unsurpassed in human history, so massive that it resulted in climate change. If you ever take a look at the Anthropocene Age, Anthropocene, the Age of Man, that is a new term that traces back to the genocide of the American hemisphere that resulted in 124 million deaths, all the way from the circle in the poles, all the way to the Cape Horn in the bottom of South America, in Patagonia, towards the Antarctic. You've got from the polar circle to the Antarctic, 124 million native indigenous peoples were eradicated by intentionally spread disease, by genocide. This led to climate change, a change in our entire nature of existence. It led into the devastation of food products, the introduction of new ones. It led to the population explosion in China. All of this is known as the Anthropocene Age, which goes back to the scumbag of the earth, Christopher Columbus, the inhuman madman who began to murder people in a place known as Utopia. If you ever take a look at Sir Thomas More's Utopia, he got information from sailors before Columbus who told of the Taino peoples, T-A-I-N-O, and the Taino peoples of the Caribbean are exterminated. They no longer exist. There's nothing left of them but words like hammock and hurricane, which we get from them. They existed in a state of idyllic bliss. There was nothing but a tropical environment in which fruit fell off the trees and fish jumped out of the sea. And they walked around naked without any clothing and got their food from the sea in front of them on the beach and from the trees above them as it fell to earth. They had gold in abundance, which they wore as spangle. They had no concept of it as a currency or as something of value other than that it was pretty. So when Columbus found them, they were literally dripping in gold. And so, without war, never having known of conflict or struggle or any need to fight for anything, not a single weapon among them. They were so unfamiliar with the concept of a blade that when Columbus drew his sword to start killing them, they grabbed it by the blade, thinking that it was a gift, cutting their own fingers off. And that's when Columbus wrote in his own diary, I can kill all of them with only 20 men. And he began killing. He began a killing that never stopped. And Columbus was, of course, a Morano Jew, a Jew escaping from the Inquisition of Spain. And, of course, he wanted to conquer a new Zion for his Jewish people to move into as soon as he killed everyone else who was here. All of our empire with its Zionist influence is all thanks to Columbus, a Morano Jew. Morano, of course, was the Spanish word for pig, based on the fact that Jews were not willing to convert to Catholicism and they wouldn't eat pork. The Spanish called them pigs. And when they were discovered or uncovered as crypto-Jews, they were paraded in the streets and provided with a forcible conversion or forced to leave, or in cases turned over to the Inquisition to die. Now, many Jews died under the Inquisition. They were looking for a new place to move. That's why Columbus was funded by Jewish merchants. He answered to them and described America before he even wrote to the King and Queen of Spain. And this guy started the most massive genocide in history. So this was a Jewish genocide against the Native American peoples. And then it was taken over after all this bloodletting. This land of misery was taken over by the Freemasons, who said, this place is so cursed now. It is so soaked in blood. We can use this as a place to bring back the anti-gods that sank Atlantis and do it all over again. Now, there was someone who stood against them. And that was a person named Adam Weishaupt, who was a Bavarian, who was a Freemason, who instituted a schismatic movement known as the Bavarian Illuminati. And this schismatic movement made him the Martin Luther of the Freemasonic Church. Now, just as Martin Luther stood against the Catholics and nailed his 14 points to the wall and started a religious movement known as Protestantism, which led to the 30 years religious war, which was so massive, was so devastating, that there are still places in Europe today that have yet to recover from the devastation they suffered during that 30 years religious war of Protestants versus Catholics. So too, the Bavarian Illuminati, as originated by Adam Weishaupt, led to a war that is impacting us to this day. And Adam Weishaupt established the Bavarian Illuminati and appealed to the Roman Catholic Church to help him in his struggle against the Freemasons who had taken up the theology of deism. Now, what is deism? D-E-I-S-M. Deism. D-E-I-S, or it's spelled, deism is D-E-I-S-M. I think it's a fairly, shall we say, it's a hard spelling because it's an unusual word of deistic nature. And deism, remember, English is the third language for me. Deism is essentially the concept of a god gone away. Deism is the religion of your founding fathers. This is what differentiates them from normal Freemasons. Now, you can look up what I'm saying and verify it. Don't take my word for it. Look up the founding fathers and deism. Look up the religion of Thomas Jefferson and deism. And in terms of the deists, people ask, what are they? Where'd they go? You've never heard of them. You've never learned about them. But this was around the time of the revolution of Sir Isaac Newton in physics. It was a Newtonian revolution based on Newtonian mechanics, which is a telling term because Newton created the concept of a clockwork universe. And with the Newtonian revolution in physics, it was as massive and as devastating to his world, to his age, as the Einsteinian revolution was to the age of nuclear physics. And Newtonian mechanics was the concept of course, a clockwork universe that gave rise to the notion of a very inhuman universe that was not responding to American, or excuse me, human beseechment, human prayers, human attempts to appeal to the divinity. This gave rise to the concept of an unresponsive mechanical universe that was without a god. So the concept of deism was that the clockwork universe was so complicated that it was obviously created by an intelligence. And since it was created by an intelligence, then that intelligence is no longer responsive. That divinity, that intelligence, that creator has left. So since the divinity has left the creation, left the building, left the construct, left the physical universe, then the people to fill in that vacuum and rise to divinity themselves, to ascend to godhood, were the deists of the Freemasonic tradition. So this deistic revolution resulted in a church of the Masons, of your founding fathers, that believed that they could usurp the throne of God. And they felt that they could do this because that throne was empty. That's why all of the Masons who constructed Gothic cathedrals in Europe felt that they were building monuments to man's ignorance, houses to a god gone away, where people would beseech to no one who would respond to nothing. But they could fill that vacuum as the new gods, which is why all the original pictures of George Washington show him ascending to godhood. Original statues show this. Many of them have been hidden from public view now because they're so offensive to Christian eyes. But your founding fathers, in no way, shape, or form, were Christian. This was not a Christian republic. This was deistic. They were what you would call today Luciferian. And in this sense, the founding fathers created this base of their operations, the United States, and the opposite in Europe was being created by Adam Weishaupt. That's why America proceeded to join in three major world wars to destroy Europe. The first global war occurred directly after the American Revolution, in which what Adam Weishaupt started with church assistance and funding and sponsorship was the Schutzstaffel, The SS. And the SS was founded at the time of the Bavarian Illuminati in the 1700s through the 1800s as a revolutionary movement of pan-Europeanism that was trying to reestablish a Christian Gnosticism while respecting the traditions of the original Aboriginal peoples of Europe, the Vikings, the Norse, the Aryan peoples who had worshipped the elder gods of the Nordic peoples. And they, of course, rallied around a symbol that was described by H.P. Lovecraft in his only work to be published in his lifetime as a book, as a novel, The Shadow Over Innsmouth. So in The Shadow Over Innsmouth, H.P. Lovecraft is describing the elder sign. And he describes the elder sign is the only sign or symbol that will ward off the elder gods, the anti-gods of the Cthulhoid mythos, that which your military has come to worship under the chaplaincy of men like Michael Aquino. And that elder sign is described in The Shadow Over Innsmouth as being a swastika. Specifically, this became the symbol of the Bavarian Illuminati and the rallying symbol of the Schutzstaffel or the SS, a pan-European movement of many nationalities based on separate but equal, which is why the SS in the Second World War had national units, Dutch units, Nordic units, Germanic units, Asian Indian units, various ethnic units of different nationalities fighting for a separate equality. And in terms of National Socialism and the idea of the mass sacrifices of the Jewish people who had been responsible for so much death in the Americas, they were sacrificing them to bring back the elder gods of the Norse, Odin, Thor, the various gods. This is why Colonel Michael Aquino, during the 1980s, traveled to the Schutzstaffel Castle of Wevelsburg, spelled with W's, it's pronounced as a V in the Germanic, W-E-L-S-B-E-R-G. And Wevelsburg Castle was where he held an inversion ceremony to ritually suppress the return of the Aryan elder gods because they were a threat to his anti-gods of chaos that the American military worships. Now, he could do this because he was on secondment to NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, and had an international security clearance as a member of the World Affairs Council. So you can look this up. Don't take my word for it. Look up Colonel Michael Aquino going into Germany, going to Wevelsburg Castle, the castle of the Schutzstaffel, the Waffen-SS, or the weaponized SS under Heinrich Himmler, and this castle was the site of his satanic inversion ritual to suppress the return of the elder gods that were returning in faith today due to the mass ritual sacrifices held by the National Socialists of the murderous Jews who had killed so many people in the New World in North and South America. And when he held this inversion ritual, he came back because he was expelled. They deported him out of Germany because the neo-Nazi or National Socialists Underground appealed to the German government that he was desecrating a national monument. So he was ultimately expelled out of Germany, came back to the United States after conducting that ritual of suppression. And that is why the United States hates Nazism, hates Adam Weishaupt. This is why Robert Anton Wilson, whose original name, Robert Anton Wilson, who wrote the Illuminati trilogy, Robert Anton Wilson's original name was Robert Edward Wilson. He changed it to Anton Wilson because he named himself after his satanic priest, Anton Zandor LaVey. So Robert Anton Wilson was a Satanist, and he was a contract writer, a hack writer, and he wrote the Illuminati trilogy to make a villain of Adam Weishaupt because that was the founding father of the Schutzstaffel, or the SS, which has been defending Europe in three world wars against the United States. And the United States, shortly after its revolution, joined in the first global war of the Napoleonic conflict. That's when Thomas Jefferson, and you had, of course, the president of the United States at that time, who was the individual who joined the Napoleonic Empire in war against the conservative monarchies of the Anglo-Dutch Empire. And the Napoleonic Empire was founded on the American Revolutionary model. The Napoleonic Empire was a result of the French Revolution, inspired by the shot heard around the world in 1775, and the French Revolution was very totalitarian, communistic. It originated its own calendrical system, which of course Napoleon had to get rid of as being impractical, and the French Revolution resulted in Napoleon fighting against the conservative monarchies of Europe that had told the Americans to stop advancing and killing Indians beyond the Appalachian Mountains on the maritime seaboard of the Atlantic American region. And the king, of course, was viewed as an enemy of the Americans. They went to war against him. They dispatched the Marines overseas to fight the conservative empires, such as the Sultanates of Turkey and their allied Muslim nations on North Africa. And these, of course, were in alliance with the conservative British and the Dutch against the Napoleonic Empire, which invaded Egypt. So to the aid of the Napoleonic Empire, the Americans sent the United States Marines. And the United States Marines invaded Libya. And during this first global conflict of the Napoleonic Empire, which had conflict saw in the Middle East, Napoleon was en route to invasion of Jerusalem, and he had forces that were fighting Dutch interests in Indonesia. This was the world's first global war. It's known in occult history as World War Zero. So during this first global conflict, World War Zero, America was on the side of the Axis of the French against the conservative European monarchies, and they lost. Now, the Europeans didn't have enough manpower to invade North America, so they rallied the Canadians. And what the Americans call the War of 1812 is part of the Napoleonic conflict. So the Canadians invaded Washington, D.C., and burned it to the ground. Now, people will say, oh, it's Royal Marines. That's all a crock of shit. These were Canadians born and bred, and the Canadians invaded the United States. They kicked America's ass. They burned the Capitol to the ground. What used to be called the Pink House was entirely destroyed because it was pink, and they rebuilt it as the White House. And this was done as part of the Napoleonic Wars, which the Americans lost. See, Americans fought against the Europeans, attempted to destroy their culture, lost spectacularly. Their capital was burned to the ground. So the Americans came back for round two with World War I. And during World War I, they unleashed an influenza called the Spanish flu. They had just fought a war with Spain, the Spanish-American War, and they knew all about the creation of disease and its impact as a weapon of war, because this had been known about from back in the days of the Black Plague, which had been spread by the Mongols. And the Mongols had eliminated a great deal of the world's population with the spread of that virus. Now, when people started coming to North America, they were pilgrims, Puritans, Bostonians, and one of them was Cotton Mather. And they began to die of smallpox until one of their African-American slaves taught them how to vaccinate. And smallpox would have killed that entire colony, and it would have disappeared like Roanoke in Virginia if it hadn't been to a black slave by the name of Onesimus. And it was spelled Onesimus, as I believe it was pronounced Onesimus. And Onesimus was had a name. You can look him up. His name was spelled O-N-E, like one, S-I-M-U-S, Onesimus, or Onesimus. Onesimus was a African voodoo doctor. He was taken as a slave, and he taught Cotton Mather how to vaccinate the people by taking one bit of smallpox leaking from the pustules of victims and introducing it to a paper cut introduced into healthy people so that they could get a small dose of the smallpox, which their body could adapt to, and then become immune to. This was vaccination. Now, Cotton Mather learned this, and he saved that entire colony using what was called variolation. This is what George Washington used to save the Continental Army when they were fighting the British, and all the black slaves that they had imported began to infect them with smallpox. And so he took this variolation taught by Onesimus, and George Washington saved the Continental Army, and he was able to carry out his war against the British. Now, the Americans knew all about disease as a weapon of war. So what happened was during World War I, the Kaiser and Germany won the war. They defeated Russia. And as a result, they signed what was called the Brest-Litovsk Treaty. And the Brest-Litovsk Treaty, something you can look up, B-R-E-S-T, a city in Poland, dash Litovsk, L-I-T-O-V-S-K, another city in Poland. And the Brest-Litovsk Treaty gave Germany 25% of Russia's population, about a quarter of all of its landmass, and the majority of its industry. Now the Germans were going to use all of that to roll over the Europeans of France, and the Americans were sending an expeditionary force of a few thousand men that were going to be nothing but speed bumps. So President Wilson said, I want to destroy Europe and rewrite it as part of a New World Order. Now, anyone who disbelieves this can look up his name tagged with New World Order. You'll find entire books written on President Woodrow Wilson saying he wanted to establish a New World Order. And this man was approached by General Gorgas, the Surgeon General of the United States. By the way, military doctors are not subject to the Hippocratic Oath. And Surgeon General Gorgas got together with William Welsh, who was in charge of the Rockefeller Institute for Medicine, which took over the medical industry of the United States within 1 year. They bullied, bought, and sold out hospitals the way that they did the oil industry, and within 1 year, the number of hospitals was cut in half in the United States. They shut down half the hospitals in the United States and bought up the rest so that they were all owned by Rockefeller. And Rockefeller established the Rockefeller Institute for Medicine, which is now known as Rockefeller University. Now, the reason you don't know about any of this was because he bought the Encyclopedia Britannica, which was the major source of information at that time, and rewrote all of history so that nobody would know this. But if you do your research, you'll find out everything I say is true. And Rockefeller, of course, with Rockefeller University, had William Welsh, and they approached the Surgeon General, and they said, we can create a disease that'll wipe out Europe. So they took conscripts, they drafted criminals, prisoners, out of San Quentin, right here in California. That's why I worked with the documents. I worked with the documents because 25% of the United States Army's doctors that don't follow or swear to the Hippocratic Oath, 25% were trained at Letterman Army Medical Center at any given time. So Letterman Army Medical Center had all the records. So they conscripted men, prisoners, out of San Quentin, shipped them in unrefrigerated boxcars, loaded with live chickens. So they would all catch chicken roll by the time they reached Fort Leavenworth in Kansas. And by the time they got to Kansas, they found all of these prisoners had died, but they infected the rest of the recruits with H1N1, hemagglutinin 1, neuromodase 1, V-T-H-E, with a capital, uppercase T-H-E, the avian swine flu virus. So when they created this terrible disease, the one man who proved immune as carrier that they could find was Walter Gitchell. And they made him the cook so that he could give it to everybody through the food. And they made them all sleep together so they could spread it to each other. Now, you can see this in photographs. You can look it all up yourself. And then by the time they sent them to disembark at Spain, which they had defeated in a war, they disembarked, and that's why they called it the Spanish flu, but they disembarked in what we call death ships, or coffin ships, because all the troops arrived dead. The few survivors were carriers. They threw them into the trenches. They infected everybody else. And within a single year, they killed 100 million people worldwide. Now, this so-called Spanish flu in American records is known as the American Army Flu. Records I worked with at Letterman Army Medical Center, which no longer exists. The entire place was destroyed after they closed the Presidio military base down. Now, this American Army Flu, this Spanish flu, killed more people in a single year than AIDS killed in 24 years. No, it killed more people in 24 hours than AIDS killed in 24 years. It killed more people in a single year than the Black Plague did in 100 years. All of this is verifiable. It's medical history. It's incontrovertible. It's inarguable. It's true. So the Americans conducted the largest genocide in history against the European peoples and people all over the world, and 20 million Americans died as a result. And they knew this was going to happen because it was going to be blowback, because they created this disease. So many people died, they ran out of coffins in 1 week. And after that, they had to bury everybody in mass graves. Every major city in the United States, from the Atlantic to the Pacific, from Oakland to Chicago to New York, has mass graves hidden under the city from the time of the American Army flu, what was propagandized as Spanish flu. And all of these people are hidden under mass graves beneath concrete and various parking lots that you'll never know about. But if you look up the research, you'll find they had to be buried by bulldozers because they couldn't bury them with people anymore because all the people were dying. And nobody was alive to really bury these people, so they had to get some people in bulldozers to bulldoze them into mass graves that they cemented over. This is all true. It's all fact. 20 million people died in the United States. 100 million people worldwide. Now think about what I'm saying. That was how you won World War I. Then World War I was won, and then you had to have a second war, World War II, in which you came into direct combat with the SS. This is the whole reason America's been in three major wars against Europe. It wants to sink that continent the way it sank Atlantis, because that's how the American deists feel they can bring back the anti-gods, which the neo-national socialist underground holds away with their ward, their sign of protection, their seal, the swastika, which is why it's so reviled against in America, which is why it's so propagandized against in America, which is why Adam Weishaupt is reviled and propagandized against by hack Satanists like Robert Anton Wilson, who even changed his name to reflect that of his master, Anton Zandor LaVey.
Let me jump in real quick. You talk about these different symbols of power, Sigils or energy signs to either usher in different elder gods, anti-gods, or keep them at bay. Why do people like Aleister Crowley, Michael Aquino, worship such entities? Why do they want to bring them down to earth and create such destruction? What's in it for them?
They're hoping that by the destruction of this universe, they can usurp the throne of God. The original building, the Pentagon, was built by a Satanist,
Colonel, or at that time he was a general, Leslie Groves. And Leslie Groves took a golden shovel and he turned the dirt, a spade, in the groundbreaking ceremony for the Pentagon on September 11th, 1941. And this was the largest office building in the world. It's still the largest office building in the world, and it's shaped as the core of a satanic pentagram. And General Leslie Groves, when he turned the spade, that golden spade in this groundbreaking ceremony, basically had deported, rendered homeless, thousands of black families in what was known as Hell's Bottom neighborhood to clear the way for the Pentagon. So all these families were being uprooted and displaced and rendered homeless, and he told them, go join the military, because I'm going to start the biggest war the world has ever seen, and more people are going to die than have ever died before. And we're going to build this building, the Pentagon, without a single ounce of metal or steel in it. It's all concrete because we need every ounce of steel for guns and planes and tanks and ships. And that's why they dismantled the rail on the Golden Gate Bridge. There used to be a monorail on the Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco, which was built entirely out of the Presidio military base. Every screw, every rivet, every cable that went into that Golden Gate Bridge came out of the Presidio military base. It went through there to undergo military inspection because it was a military highway in the event of war. And they wanted to make sure there were no saboteurs who could compromise its construction so that it could be brought down to plug up the bay, because the San Francisco Golden Gate was still the gateway to the Orient throughout the Second World War and well into the Vietnam War. That's why it was responsible for the 17 Western states, including the United States-occupied nation of Hawaii. So you've got this Golden Gate Bridge that used to have a monorail that was entirely dismantled for tanks and ships and guns and planes, as well as all kinds of other metal structures, and there wasn't any metal left for the Pentagon, the largest office building in the world, so it was completely built out of concrete. And then what happens was that the U.S. government held an audit, and they found out the Pentagon had stolen billions and billions, trillions of dollars, trillions. They couldn't account for it. And they said, let's start an audit. And so the Pentagon, which on any given day holds thousands of people, 1,500 people are there any given day. On September 11th, 2001, the 60th anniversary of the Pentagon and its groundbreaking ceremony underfoot of General Leslie Groves on September 11th, 1941, there were supposed to be 3,000 people there or more for its ceremonies, for its celebration, for its anniversary, but they were all gone. Everybody was gone. The only people in the Pentagon were in this one wing of the building that they had reinforced with metal. Just the month before, they had taken all of the windows and reinforced them with blast windows that could withstand, theoretically, a nearby nuclear explosion. They entered sprinkler systems, which had never been introduced before because it's a concrete building and it can't burn. And they introduced safety doors that never existed before for exits that otherwise wouldn't exist. And they introduced this metal framework so the whole building wouldn't collapse, because concrete and a plane crashing into it would collapse the building and everybody would die. So that way they kept everybody alive who wasn't the auditor. The only people who died were the auditors investigating the Pentagon theft of trillions of dollars. So when that plane or missile, whatever it was, went into that building, it stood long enough for all the military personnel to escape, and everybody who died was involved with the audit.
I'm glad you brought up the fact, Douglas, that the only people that did die in the Pentagon September 11th, 2001 were tax auditors. That's insanity. And the date that it took place would make me think there's something that we can't see that's harvesting that energy from people dying, some type of dark ecstasy. It's feeding off of this pain and this suffering and this death. And then I've heard before also the Pentagon was designed specifically to harbor certain entities and energy forces, what many call demons. Is there truth to that?
Absolutely. That's what it was meant to release. It released a new age of darkness and violence that was part of that sacrificial ceremony. People who died in the Pentagon that day were elderly people visiting relatives. One of the men who died was in his 70s, and young children who were in the daycare center. One person who died there in the Pentagon that day was 7 years old. So from the age of 7 to 70, everybody who was there who died, none of them were military unless they were involved with the audit. Most of them were civilian auditors. All the military escaped for all the reasons I articulated. Think of the evil that I'm saying. Everybody got a phone call and said, don't show up for work. How is that not a conspiracy? How is that not a conspiracy at that on any normal day, especially the anniversary day when there's supposed to be double, triple number of the people there? Nobody's there. That's your military. For God's sake, dismantle your satanic military. For God's sake. And what was it special about General Leslie Groves? He was in charge of the plutonium bomb, which went off at Trinity site
in an inversion ceremony of the Holy Trinity, they blew the plutonium bomb, which physicists had said could potentially destroy the world. And the physicist said, you know, one atom causing another to billard out, to like the game of billiards, into a kind of chain reaction that would destabilize all the atoms of matter in one area, theoretically will not stop. Theoretically, we should destroy the entire planet with the testing of this plutonium bomb at Trinity site. And of course, the military thought that was great because they were losing their ass in the war. The SS was defeating them, and just like the Kaiser had done in World War I. And they said, there's no way we can win this war. And they said, what do we do? Let's destroy the world. And then we destroy the work of the divinity. That means we take his place. The elder gods will honor us, the anti-gods. And the anti-gods will make us as unto gods. And we can recreate the world in our image. That's their insanity. They tried that then. And that's their entire purpose for trying to destroy Europe ever since. This is why they hate that which defends Europe, National Socialismus, and the swastika, and the Schutzstaffel of the SS. Now, does it all make sense? The three wars, the American involvement in Europe and its attempt to destroy it consistently, the American, instead of Americans coming from Europe and being allied to Europe, America has found itself at war with Europe through three major wars. How is this not making America the enemy of what was once Christendom? The closest concept we had to Europe prior to a concept of Europe was Christendom. And of course, this is a situation which, as I said, Adam Weishaupt ultimately got his sponsorship from the Catholic Church. The entire SS organization, including the weaponized SS, the Waffen-SS under Heinrich Himmler, was modeled on the Society of the Jesuits in terms of its ranks of order and infrastructure. And Adolf Hitler even referred to Heinrich Himmler as my Ignatius. So Ignatius Loyola, of course, was the founder of the Society of the Jesuits, the SJ. So we have a situation in which the Church represented Europe until the time of the Transcendence, of a new age in which the elder gods were being called upon to return, those of Thor, Woden, Freya, the gods of the Norse, the Vikings, the original European inhabitants. The Americans fear this more than anything else because these are the gods who could stand against their anti-gods. Because the Americans don't believe the original god of the Bible or the god of Abraham to be a threat because they feel he is gone. So these elder gods of the Norse Aryan peoples are what threaten them. That is why they fight so hard against it. Does it make sense now, the religious nature of these world wars?
You know, it's also interesting because you bring up these elder gods that predate the Christian era, or Yahshuvah or Yodavah, as he's pronounced in the Old Testament. And there's been a lot of TV shows out lately and movies that are portraying these ancient gods, these elder gods, like Thor, Odin, etc. It seems as if the underlying faction of all of these gods, though, is they all demand sacrifice and bloodletting, etc. Is one really any different than the other?
Well, it's important to remember that when one studies Jewish Kabbalistic tradition, and it's very important to remember that the way Americans interpret Judaism is a farce. The Americans have a concept of Israel and the peoples of Israel being the people of Abraham. These are mostly Ashkenazi Jews who are, of course, of Turkic descent ethnically. They're an entirely different race from Sephardim Jews who are more connected to the Abrahamic bloodline. And the God of Abraham, the Abrahamic peoples are Semitic, and as are the Levantine Arabs and the Arabs in general. The Arabic people are Semitic. Now, what was established in the State of Israel was a Turkic ethnic, Caucasian European white settler regime, which has instituted an apartheid against the Semitic Levantine peoples after conducting ethnic cleansing, which resulted in al-Nakba, as it's known by the Palestinians, or the catastrophe. That's their name. The Jews, of course, refer to Hashoah, or the catastrophe, as being the Holocaust, or the genocide of European Jewry. Now, both these people use the same term for their personal or ethnic Holocaust. Now, the Semitic peoples, the Palestinians, were, of course, murdered in what numbered to eventually a million within a very short period of time during the ethnic cleansing of the Palestinians and the establishment of the State of Israel. Now, these Americans aligned themselves with this Turkic ethnic white settler apartheid state as the people of Abraham, which they are not. They're not ethnically in any way, shape, or form connected to the original Jewish peoples. And, of course, the Americans view this as somehow being symbolic of the end times, of why we fight, quote-unquote. What we are defending in the United States is this 51st state
of Israel, which, of course, is represented by the divinity or the God of Abraham, the creator. Now, all of this has nothing to do with your leadership. Your leadership is your military. Your military takes all the money. Your military decides who they're going to fight. And they sure as hell are starting every war that they can against what they consider a threat. Now, their wars are against primarily who they propagandize against, people who they deem to be National Socialistisch or of the European Aryan descent, the people who are followers through the new Gnostic Christian neo-pagan tradition, the followers of the religion of the SS, the Schutzstaffel, as organized by Adam Weishaupt. And one asks, well, with the massive genocide that occurred in Europe of European Jewry, are these gods better that are returning, that are coming back in force, that are becoming a force to be reckoned with as a new religion? And of course they are. If you take a look at the anti-gods that the Americans appeal to, take a look at the culture of genocide behind them, compare the statistics. Just in terms of numbers and ratio of people alone that have been killed, the original indigenous peoples of North and South America, 125 million. The people killed in World War II by the American incepted army flu, 100 million worldwide. When you take a look at, that's 200 million right there. When you take a look at all the other deaths involved, we're talking hundreds of millions of people have died as a result of the American worship of the anti-gods, who are not gods in the sense of the elder gods of the Aryan Nordic Viking peoples. These elder gods were like the Aztec gods, gods of blood and war, gods that needed a bloodletting, that demanded to be fed by the struggle. But in return, they promised fertility of body and of field. The Aztec Empire was one of the most advanced in the world. The Viking Empire was one of the most advanced in terms of European indigenous cultures, not impacted by the Oriental cultures of Byzantium and Semitic Christianity, which came out of the East. So you're talking about a native indigenous European culture that was able to sail the world and colonize America in a non-violent sense, where they didn't exterminate the Indians. At this point in history, it's inarguable. It's incontrovertible. The first people to reach here long before Columbus were the Norsemen, the Vikings. They almost certainly taught the Indians about sweat lodges, which they originated in the fjords of Norway and various other parts of Scandinavia. Their concept of interaction with the Native Americans was entirely peaceful. So here we have a cultural tradition whose major violence has been against one of the most genocidal forces of our civilization, of humanity. Their major conflict was with the Jewish people of Europe that were Ashkenazim, Turkic Caucasoids, that came into Eastern Europe from out of the Khazar Empire, which were Turkish peoples who were converted to Judaism under the Crusades or the Jihads of the militant people of Abraham centuries ago. Now, just as the Muslims orchestrated jihad, just as the Christians organized crusade, the Jewish people had what they called a Holocaust. This is what developed in the land of Canaan. When the Jewish people were ejected from Egypt, they had to find new land to settle in. Well, the best land in the Levantine was known in the ancient days as Canaan, only it was filled with Canaanites. So what they did was they sacrificed them all on a pillar of burnt offering to their god, Yahweh. And this was known in their language as Holocaust. The term Holocaust is the very Jewish word for jihad or crusade. And the Canaanites were sacrificed, man, woman, and child, the entire nation, burned alive in a Holocaust as an offering to the bloodthirsty divinity, the God of Abraham of the Old Testament. That is not the God of Christianity. The God of Christianity is the God of the New Testament, who came to earth as a human being in a human form to understand human problems, who organized a new covenant with everyone, making himself everyone's God as opposed to the God of the Jews. Now, that God is your God if you're a Christian, not the God of the Old Testament, who was a God of war and blood sacrifice, sacrificed by fire, sacrificed by Holocaust. Now, that very Holocaustic technique was used by Christopher Columbus when he killed what ultimately amounted to 124 million people throughout the American hemisphere. Now, compare that genocide, what the Schutzstaffel fought against in Europe, what they fought against in World War II, to the genocide
of Canaan, to the genocide in the Americas, to the genocide of the Americans with what they unleashed in World War I, which guaranteed by Wilson's redrawing the map and creating nations that had never before existed. On the map of World War I Europe, there's three nations in Europe. There's Germany, there's Russia, and there's Austria-Hungary. That's it. Out of that, Woodrow Wilson created artificial nations that hadn't existed ever before. Nations he made up in his psychotic deranged mind, his diseased brain. And that's exactly what led to World War II. So you've got the Americans and what they've done in the name of the anti-gods, and you've got what the Aryan peoples have done in the name of the elder gods. Which side are you going to choose? All of the rest of the world, from Africa to Asia, thinks of the Third Reich as the good guys. Only in America and the degenerate West do they think of them as the bad guys. That's because all of the genocide, when I went into Africa and the capital of Uganda, there was a statue of Adolf Hitler built by Idi Amin Dada. And once they found out my name was Dietrich and my last name was Germanic, my money was no good anymore. They gave me everything for free. I said, why do you like Germans so much? And they said, well, we've been a British colony for so long, and the British have done terrible things to us. And we love the Germans because they are white people who eat white people. And when we take a look at their death camps, we see no colored people, no brown, no yellow, no black. All the people they killed were white, the evil people of the world. That's how the world views the Germans. That's how the world views the Nazis. Only the people who they killed, the white people, hate them. Now, does that put the world in perspective for you?
Well, it's just as if the database of knowledge that is able to be explored is minuscule in comparison to what was available many years ago. For example, the Library of Alexandria that was burnt to the ground back in the Crusades.
It's important to remember that the Library of Alexandria, and again, this is historical simplification that you're reiterating because you have no choice. You have no choice because the information that you have is from the internet, which, of course, is run by DARPA. These are the same people pumping you full of child pornography. So everything you're getting is wrong. The Library of Alexandria underwent multiple burnings. The first time it was burned was by the pagans, who were under Caesar. The second time it was burned was by the Christians. Then it was burned by the Muslims. Jihad. It's been burned by everybody. Okay, so there's been multiple destructions of an amassing of knowledge at the Library of Alexandria. So people are simply picking and choosing who they want you to despise when they speak of the Library of Alexandria. Don't buy into it. Okay, that's simplification. That's revisionism. Okay, so the reality is, when you take a look at the evils that you speak of under Christianity, those occurred under the church. They did not occur under Christianity, which was originally very affiliated with the practice of magic.
Gnosticism.
That's quite correct, an aspect of it. But there was also Christianity that was not Gnostic, but Pistic. Gnosis means knowledge. Pistis means faith. That is the difference between people who would later cleave to the church and people who cleaved to Gnosticism, which became, of course, militant and resurgent under the Schutzstaffel, as originated by Adam Weishaupt, with the help of the Catholic Church, because they realized that a populist movement was needed to rally the pagans of Europe who had never died out. The church had suppressed them, but the church had not annihilated or exterminated them. All of that came back in resurgence with the Third Reich. Adolf Hitler himself was a Catholic who had been baptized as such, and he never revoked his Catholicism, and of course was considered such by the Pope, who had originated many so-called rat lines or escape routes out of the Vatican for many of the National Socialistas to South America. So you have this cooperation because the greatest enemy of the church was the Freemasons. What had happened to make the church so corrupt today? What happened to make the church a church of pedophiles and molesters? Well, what happened at the time of Adam Weishaupt when he organized the Schutzstaffel? His major sponsorship was from the church, who no longer had consecrated armies of crusaders. So they began to back, in this time of Renaissance, this time of deism and atheism, this time of a lack of faith, this time of a questioning of the centrality of Earth in the universe, all of this that was brought forth at the time of this new nationalism that led to the Napoleonic Empire in the world's first global war, World War Zero. This was what the church was contending with, and so that's why they sponsored a defender that would preserve Europe, if not the church, the Europe of Gnostic pagans. And the Schutzstaffel, getting the sponsorship from the church, modeling its organization on the Jesuits, was the greatest threat to the American anti-godly anti-deists, so the anti-theists, or who were deists. They were anti-theistic as opposed to atheistic. They weren't
atheistic like the communists who don't believe in God. They were anti-God, so they were anti-theistic. That is what deism produces. What the Freemasons developed was a permanent instruction called the Alta Vendita. And the Alta Vendita was, of course, a vendetta. The Alta Vendita is a Masonic blueprint for the subversion of the Catholic Church. You can look this up. You can do research yourself. The permanent instruction of the Alta Vendita was basically a booklet, so to speak, like Mao Zedong's Little Red Book, that was an instruction for the Masons outlining a plan to subvert the Catholic Church. Now, the actual Masonic document was asked to be published for public perusal by both Pope Pius and Pope Leo in the 1850s and the 1870s. So we've got this known conspiracy that was originated that ultimately has brought the Catholic Church down to its point of corruption, which we sadly see today. That's a Masonic, anti-theistic, deistic conspiracy outlined. And this is an actual publication. This is real. It's not a forgery like the protocols of the Elders of Zion. This is the real thing. So keep that in mind and what your Europe was fighting against. All of the white Americans in the United States generally source genetically from the European continent, and yet you are part of a republic which has sought nothing but the European continent's destruction, the destruction of its people, to the point where it almost exterminated them with the introduction of the American Army flu in World War I. Now, how can you not take sides in this and take the right side of what has been struggling against America's attempt to destroy the world? How could you side with anyone who blew what they did at Trinity under the thought that the world would be destroyed?
And I got to jump in here real quick because you're talking about these psychopaths that are hell-bent on destroying the world. And it reminds me of the recent trip that I took out to Dulce, New Mexico to get some video footage out there of the Archuleta Mesa and its surrounding areas. But I have a military-grade Geiger counter that's built into my watch. So everywhere I go, I can keep track of the radiation levels. I purchased it a couple years after Fukushima just because I wanted to be aware of how much radiation we were actually being exposed to and not just believe what I found on the internet. So out in Dulce, New Mexico, radiation levels were hovering around 0.17, 0.18 microsieverts per hour, which is substantially higher than down here in the South and as well as many places that I've been to on the East Coast, Midwest, and Northwest. But there was a project out there in 1967 called Project Gas Buggy, where the Department of Defense, as well as some other energy organizations, got together and they detonated a nuclear bomb underground about 38 miles northwest of Dulce. So for whatever reason they decided to do that, I don't know the official version. It was supposed to be something good, but I don't know how you're going to get anything productive out of a nuclear bomb being detonated underground except for destruction. But people that I've talked to, like Dane Wigington, that is a specialist in chemtrails and how that's affecting the planet, it sounds like it's just completely destroying the ozone, the Fukushima disaster, the Gulf oil disaster. So many catastrophes take place. There's certainly people out there that could care less about the planet, and it's just very remarkable that even today, people in high positions of power still care absolutely nothing about the future of mankind. And I've got many friends and family members that are a part of the U.S. military in every branch, the Army, the Air Force, the Navy, and they would give you the shirt off their back. They're very good, genuine people. Most Americans today, I feel, are good people. But with that being said, so many are uninformed, undereducated, ignorant, and it seems as if entire societies, because I've been from the West Coast to the East Coast to the Midwest, I've been in almost every state and almost every good-sized city and small town in the U.S. I've traveled the country quite extensively, and it does seem as if most people within this populace are under some type of mind control or hypnosis.
Well, keep in mind, of course there's good men in the military, just like, to put this into context, there are innocent men in prison. Their prison is full of innocent men. There's plenty of men who have been wrongfully convicted and are unjustly serving time. This happens all the time, and this happens despite DNA testing. Some of them have been rescued from that horrible situation because of DNA testing. There's nothing you can do to give a man back his life after that. His life is destroyed when he serves time when he's innocent. It is a horrible thing to see. This is what happens to good men in the military. My father was in the military all his life. He was a sailor for over 30 years. When we buried him,
His headstone in upstate New York, George Joseph Henry Dietrich, his headstone reads World War II, Korea, and Vietnam. He was in all three of those conflicts, and he was in the in theater, the China Command, with the gunboat sailors, as portrayed in the movie that starred Steve McQueen, known as The Sand Pebbles. He was there on that front long before there was a Second World War that was legally declared. So my father was in four major conflicts. When he died, we had over a dozen medals pinned to his chest that we buried him with on his uniform. And so here's the situation on man. I considered one of the best men to have ever lived. He's a saint. And my late and sainted father was a victim. He was a victim of the military. Nothing good ever came in his life of the military other than his marriage to my late and sainted mother, who was like his third or fourth wife, maybe his fifth. And he met her overseas. He was married to her, but it wasn't a happy marriage. But they stayed married because of myself as a child, my sister. And of course, I consider him a good man. The point is, he was a victim of an evil system. And of course, when I went in with my eyes wide open. I knew what I was getting into, and I wanted only the training so I could go into private mercenary work and earn some real money. Thankfully, a series of circumstances resulted in my being in the Marine Corps for a very short period of time, pretty much around 2 years, a little bit less than that, conceivably, when I look back on it. But I served in Operation Desert Shield and Operation Desert Storm, which all occurred within a relatively short period of time. So even though I was in the Marine Corps less than 2 years, I got my training, and I got out of there without having been polluted by the anthrax vaccine, because I saw what it was doing to others exactly as you described, and was able to avoid it through, again, a series of fortuitous circumstances and a lot of personal conspiracy on my part. Now, all of that it leads me to reemphasize this. Your military is not a military. It is a jail dodge and a welfare state. Okay, it's not meant to fight any war. And in terms of many of the men who are in it, who might be as unto the demographics or the statistical number thereof, equal to that of innocent men in prison, no, the rest are basically people who would otherwise be in prison. Now, much has been done to rehabilitate the image of the military man after Vietnam, who was commonly viewed as a criminal. That was done during the Rambo era of movies and its franchise. And all of this was, of course, worthwhile. It was a necessary kind of balance to America's hatred of the soldiers as opposed to the military machine. Unfortunately, many people are trying to give our modern military that same venue or that same pastiche of respectability. It's not there. In terms of the people who go into the military now, people ought to be listening to me. My voice should be out there. It should be known at this point that it's something you should never do. If anyone voluntarily goes in there now, they're a fool. Most of the men who are going in there, this was shown on 60 Minutes, a number of other specials and documentaries, are people who were given it as an alternative to jail, like they used to do in Vietnam. And so many of these men who are there are criminals. I'll give you a good example of what you're faced with. You get some golden boy, like, Patrick Tillman. Patrick Tillman got a multi-million dollar NFL contract, and he turned it down because 9/11. On 9/11, he said, I want to serve my country. He joined the United States Army. He became a member of the United States elite U.S. Army Rangers. These are the same mofos who had Sergeant Stebbins in their midst and in their ranks. He tried to lead his Rangers up a charge on a hill in Afghanistan, and they said, dude, we're here to rape babies. We're here to kill girls. What, are you crazy? We aren't here to fight no enemy. He said, no, you're here to charge. We're going to charge that hill, and they shot him to pieces. And even the U.S. Army coroner said that every bullet in Patrick Tillman's body came from behind his back. It's all up and down his spine. It all came from an American M16 at point blank range. His own Rangers shot him. And that's what happens when you get some innocent golden boy, some wholesome do-gooder, some Dudley Do-Right, who's surrounded by an organization of criminals. Now, that happens all the time. You take a look at the rest of these interactions. It's the same way. I could go on and on. Great example. Oh, God. There's a documentary called The Dark Side of Al-Dura. And The Dark Side of Al-Dura, Al-Dura is an Arabic word. It's spelled in the English phoneticization A-L-D-O-U-R-A. A-L-D-O-U-R-A. Look that up, The Dark Side of Al-Dura. If you ever watch the documentary The Dark Side of Al-Dura, they talk about Needham. And Needham, N-E-E-D-H-A-M. John Needham, whatever his first name was, surname I believe was Needham. And he was an American Army Ranger. He had no narrative in which to contextualize what he saw to be satanic sacrifice, what he saw to be the legacy of satanic chaplaincy. He was in this U.S. Army Ranger unit where there's graphic footage, there's graphic photography in this documentary. Don't watch it unless you're prepared to see people's brains being taken out of their skulls. He saw fellow Army Rangers cracking open the skulls of young boys' heads, taking out their brains and eating them. That's a satanic sacrament. I would have known exactly what was going on. I could have warned him about this. It drove him crazy. He went insane. He took the photographs and sent them back to the U.S. Army High Command to report war crimes. But they're all Satanists and they all do the same thing. So they did their bit on him and beat the shit out of him, locked him up in a hundreds of degrees. If you ever go there in the desert, it's well over 100 degrees in the sunlight. And of course, it's so hot that if you've got polish on your boots, that shoe polish will melt right off. Indeed, the sneakers will melt. You can put sneakers and boots on the ground. They'll melt under the sun. They put him in those temperatures inside of a locked storage box with no air. Burned his skin off. Burned all his skin off. Locked him in there naked so his naked flesh is touching the metal. He burned alive. Then they sent him home, all crazy, all beat up. He killed his girlfriend. After he killed her, they stuck him in an insane asylum. Finally, he just died right in front of his father, like it was magic. And that Needham, John Needham, is a U.S. Army Ranger who tried to report what he saw, and his reports and his photographic evidence were all taken as just part of everyday life. This is what we do. This is what we do in the Army. How can you report this? This is our religion. Now think of your army. You can't think of it in the same light anymore. You've got to dismantle it. Stop thinking. It's like saying, sure, there's some innocent men in prison, but prison's loaded with other people you wouldn't want on the streets. At the same time, you've got to rehabilitate your prison system. It's the largest in the world. Now, so take a look at your army. How do you rehabilitate it? Much easier answer. Dismantle it. Then these men would be in jail where they belong, a lot of them. And the rest who wouldn't be doing that will be free to do something constructive with their lives. Now that's the solution.
And Douglas, I'd like to ask you one more question before we end the broadcast tonight. There are hundreds of thousands of refugees right now that are scattering across Europe and many other Western countries. Within these hundreds of thousands of people are many adult males that are in prime age and physical stature. There has been several reports of the possible reason for these, what seems to be controlled mass exodus of individuals, is to be as a Trojan horse for many governments in the West, to bring in jihadists and terrorists and trained soldiers disguised as refugees. Do you think that the people at the top levels that control so many wars and the media and the different publications on medicine and science, etc., do you think that some of these people at the top levels could actually be orchestrating these events for future wars and terrorist events?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Without question. Think about what I said about General Vallely, a co-religionist of Michael Aquino, who is basically the man who originated ISIS, which caused all this refugee flood in the first place. So think about Desert Storm, which I served in, an Operation Desert Storm back in 1991. One of the men responsible for training your officers in the United States Army was another lieutenant colonel named Timothy Chalums, C-H-A-L-L-U-M-S. Look that effer up. And his surname was spelled C-H-A-L-L-U-M-S. And this Chalums worked at SAMS, the School for Advanced Military Studies in Fort Leavenworth, Kansas, where the H1N1, hemagglutinin 1, neuromodase 1, avian swine flu was originally incepted using the technique which I articulated. Now, they originated or organized a School of Advanced Military Studies there because of that mass sacrifice which took place on those bloodied grounds of Kansas, bloody Kansas, as it was known ever since the days of the American Civil War between the states. And Lieutenant Colonel Timothy Chalums is quoted as saying that all religions of the monotheistic Abrahamite tradition, Islam, Christianity, Judaism, they're what we're fighting against. They are the true irrational evil that we fight against, because what we fight for is what he didn't describe, but with Satanism. And of course, he's the man who trained what was known as the so-called Jedi Knights, your entire officer's corps. So all of the U.S. Army officers who led Operation Desert Storm were trained and indoctrinated by men like Lieutenant Colonel Timothy Chalums of the School of Advanced Military Studies, who indoctrinated them and initiated them into the mystery religions of Satanism. Now, this kind of mentality is of the same ilk of General Vallely, who organized ISIS, which for a group of Islamic fundamentalists had the name of a pagan goddess. And what is ISIS? ISIS is an American corporation. It's headquartered in Sierra Vista, Arizona. It is an acronym for Integrated Systems Improvement Services. Their think tank is in Minden, Nevada, where they were given an entire building by the United States federal government for free. The ISIS acronym in Minden, Nevada, for their think tank is Integrated Strategic Intelligence Services. now integrated systems improvement services are the mercenaries who guard GEICO executives going down into Mexico. They've had that contract for years. GEICO, that's an acronym for Government Insurance Corporation. That's the insurance company which insures all your military. Now, these same people organized on the ground what is known in the Arabic as Al-Dulayt al-Islamiyah wa fil-Hithi al-Iraq wa Sasham, or the Islamic State of Iraq and Syria. And that's all the same people. They're bought and they're traded in terms of shares on the stock market. One of the major shareholders is, of course, the governor of Arizona, John McCain, the man who ran for president. So he has admitted, you can look this up, don't take my word for it, look up John McCain and his connection to ISIS. John McCain admitted he's got everyday contact with ISIS, America's proxy army, NATO's B team, all these morally retarded teenagers that they've given machine guns and told to go kill people. So of course, if they're coming into Europe, they're gonna start shit. So, obviously, this is Satan's own. So what do you say if you're in Europe? What should United Germany do? The answer is simple. What is the source of the problem? The source of the problem is the United States. It's sponsoring ISIS. It's a corporation headquartered in the United States in Sierra Vista, Arizona, right outside Fort Huachuca. Now, what do you do? Your enemy is the United States. If you're Europe, here's your solution. Your root of the problem is the United States. The enemy army is headquartered in the United States. To protect Europe, declare war on the United States. Institute regime change. Invade the United States and introduce a different form of government. Deconstruct its military completely because that's their form of government. That's what Europe should do. That's my answer to that. That is the answer. If you're Europe, if you were running Europe, if you're United Germany, Chancellor Schmidt, or whatever her name is, the only trained scientist to ever run a nation state since Japan's Emperor Hirohito, who was a trained marine biologist. Now I understand that perhaps the Iron Lady who ran England was also a scientist. There was a scientist who ran Poland for a short time before he was assassinated. He almost doesn't count. He was in charge for about 24 hours. But other than that, it was only Britain and Germany. And of course, we've got Japan that have had scientists who have ruled their nations. Germany is one of them. And what she should do is she should declare war on the United States and institute regime change, send in a force to invade Washington, D.C., deconstruct the United States military, get its demobilization going. That's the only way to prevent this from overwhelming Europe. That really should be done in the name of the Schutzstaffel as the defenders of the European continent and the separate but equal nations. That was the tradition of the Waffen-SS and its deployment and its organization. That is what needs to be done. So there you have it. That should end this for tonight. Give everybody enough to think about as food for thought.
That certainly is a ton of information, Douglas. If you would, give our listeners a way to contact you.
Sure, certainly. I do want people to contact me through Facebook. My Facebook community fan page is facebook.com/DouglasDwayneDietrich. Douglas spelled with one S. Dwayne, my middle name, is spelled D-U-A-N-E. My surname is spelled, just put the words diet and rich together, D-I-E-T-R-I-C-H. Make certain that facebook.com/DouglasDwayneDietrich, that you put a like on that page so I don't have to continue to pay to maintain it and its continuity. You can friend me personally on Facebook through facebook.com/Douglas D. Dietrich at my Facebook friends page, and look up my Executrix producer, Laura Lee Solomon, and contact her. Her Skype ID is Laura Lee Solomon, her full name, LauraLeeSolomon. And Laura Lee Solomon, you can Skype friend her either prior to a transmission when we're going on air for the Saturday Night Firing Lines, then Skype in during the Saturday Night Firing Lines. We'll bring you in on air. You can ask me any question you want, including how to contact me or reach my Executrix producer, etc. And also, you can contact her via Skype. Leave her a message in the Skype text box and tell her that you want to contact myself or purchase DVDs. We're making them ourselves now and just burning them off individually per each order. And of course, anybody can contact her, Laura Lee Solomon, by looking her up on Facebook, amongst my friends list on the Facebook timeline, etc. There's ways that you can find me when you put your mind to it. And I certainly appreciate people looking me up. So probably the most efficient way is through that Skype and my Executrix producer, Laura Lee Solomon. That's probably the safest and most effective and fastest way. So I want to thank Mr. Rex Baer for giving me the opportunity to bring that up with people. One of these days, maybe our next interview, we can go into a bit about why my website is down, what was going on with my former manageress, who I'm now separated with, and certainly have terminated her in terms of any semi-professional affiliation that we had. So that had to be done in terms of my own ongoing struggles with the United States government as a whistleblower. And of course, we have a situation that I always have to be very careful of whom I affiliate with. I was certainly, I'll contextualize how that came about in terms of semi-professional affiliation with herself the next time that Mr. Rexbear and I speak, and hopefully we'll speak semi-regularly as the future progresses. I wish him all the best with the leak project. Very important. At some point in the future, we'll contextualize exactly my background as a whistleblower and a public informant, and exactly what I did with the Department of Defense, etc. And certainly, I guess the only other thing that comes to mind is, once again, a shout out to Kara Mastry, who originally brought that photograph of the individual who is being touted as Michael Aquino, who is sitting with the senior Bush and Bill Clinton. That is a genuine photograph. It is not Photoshop. It's not a hoax. The individual in there is almost certainly not Michael Aquino. There is a hoax photograph, again, to warn people about, of Anton LaVey, the founder of the First Church of Satan, with Senator John Kerry. That is a hoax. But this one is not. I argue it's not Colonel Aquino, who probably would consider it beneath his dignity or his need to even sit with men like Bush and the senior and Bill Clinton. And it will instead present to you the dangers that are far more immediate that I have. And also, as I said, Kara Mastry relayed that photograph to me. Make sure to check out the Tawn Mastry Foundation, established in name of her sister, where she honors, of course, the problem of hepatitis and its challenge medically. And there's a distant relation of mine, Dr. Dietrich, and Dr. Douglas Dietrich has worked on a cure for hepatitis, which can ultimately be utilized through a vaccination or an injection process. Now, of course, vaccinations have their own controversy. I've described already their effectiveness in times before the onset of our pharmaceutical industry and its manipulation of vaccinations. So if Dr. Douglas Dietrich can somehow prevent it from being tainted by the pharmaceutical industry, industrial complex, the medical industrial complex is big pharma, then perhaps Douglas Dietrich with his cure for hepatitis can have an enormous impact on our immediate future with this terrible disease. So, you know, thank you very much for your allowing me to talk about my distant friends and relations and all the rest of this, you know, Mr. Rexbear, and I hope that yours are doing well.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. This has been 3 hours of incredible information. I really appreciate you coming out here with us and look forward to speaking with you again sometime.
Look forward to it. My best to you and yours.
A very special thank you to our guest tonight. For all of you that had the opportunity to be here with us, if you enjoyed the show, follow us on YouTube, youtube.com/clandestinetimelord, for the most recent interviews, videos, and podcasts. Or you can check us out on the World Wide Web, www.leakproject.com. Would you like to be a guest on our show? If you have information that the world needs to see and hear, send us an email, guestbookings@leakproject.com. Thank you, everybody. This is Rex Bear with Leak Project. Stay safe and be the change you want to see. Good night. From the hive mind, this is Rex Bear, hosting Leak Project. The Leak Project was created to offer awareness and information not found in the mainstream news. With over 90% of the world's media controlled by only six enormous conglomerates, many people today are looking for more accurate information. The Leak Project offers a refreshing approach to the brain drain media. Check back daily for new content as we thrive to bring you the cutting edge in news, current events, on-scene video footage, interviews, and most importantly, the truth. Tonight's guest is Douglas Dietrich, one of the most knowledgeable, controversial, and outspoken individuals on many fascinating subjects you don't learn about in school or the mainstream news. Even the alternative media has very little insight and information about much of what Douglas knows and has seen with his own two eyes. For 8 years, Douglas Dietrich was a research librarian for the Department of Defense at El Presidio, Real D, San Francisco military base. There, along with his primary duty of document destruction, he was assigned to locate and access incredibly rare occult grimoires for the officially recognized Satanic Chaplain of the United States Army, Lieutenant Colonel Michael A. Aquino. Douglas claims the true origins of America are far different than you're taught in school. Be prepared for a shocking and controversial interview that will change the paradigm of most belief systems. Mr. Dietrich speaks of occultism and Satanism within the U.S. military. Then he discusses his evidence on child abuse, pornography, blackmail, and mind control in the military and U.S. government. Douglas, it's great to have you on the show here at Leak Project. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me. It's really great to be here. Been a long time since, definitely we'll cover just a bit of the old days and get into what's going on now.
Great. And Douglas, I'd like to give you an open canvas here tonight here on the Leak Project. I'm sure you're going to bring up a plethora of topics and information. So if you would, please, how long were you in the military and what was your connection with Michael Aquino?
The military, extraordinarily short period of time. That has nothing to do with my experience with the, shall we say, in as facetious a manner as possible, the good colonel. He retired as a full bird colonel. Of course, he never retired as a general, nor did any of his affiliates because of the infamy and the baggage that was placed upon them, which they're all quite bitter about, but, you know, such is karma and sour grapes. But in terms of the affiliates I'm speaking of, just so that we can get back to them later, speaking of lieutenant colonel, at the time that I worked with them, all of these men were lieutenant colonels, and that would include James Channon and, of course, Colonel John Alexander. Now, all of these people, Colonel John Alexander, Colonel James Channon, Colonel Michael Aquino, they all retired with a full bird, as they say. In other words, they retired in colonelcy, but they didn't retire in generalcy. And in the place of that...
What does that mean?
Well, that would mean that they didn't retire as generals, which, of course, is what a commissioned officer would hope to do. Basically, what happens is if someone is, say, just behaving themselves and going to class every day, it's kind of like community college or today's sense of collegiate status. Everybody graduates. You know, all you have to do is show up for class every day. You might graduate with a real low grade, but eventually you're going to graduate. Nobody really looks at the grades unless someone's emphasizing it on their resume that they're magna cum laude or something of that nature. Instead, people will just say, oh, okay, he graduated. Now, of course, that has, as we progress into the postmodern age, less and less meaning. Education has gotten people less and less the higher their education. And in the case of the military, it's a lot like that. You basically have people who are commissioned as officers. Now, the difference between a non-commissioned and a commissioned officer is basically this. I'll go into this now because it's important. A non-commissioned officer is anyone from an enlisted man all the way up to the rank of Sergeant First Class or Master Sergeant or, in the case of the Navy, Chief Petty Officer. And you have this very bizarre kind of gray area known as warrant officers. Warrant officers are the best of both worlds, where they're not commissioned, but at the same time, nobody can touch them because their specialty is valuable enough where officers can't chew them out or put them in the brig. So they have everybody by the balls, so to speak, by the value of their technical expertise. And they just kind of meander about as old men who are supposedly helping the military to function smoothly, which of course it does anything but. Now, in terms of the non-commissioned peoples, this goes all the way back to George Washington and, of course, their officer class. The non-commissioned peoples, from enlisted men up to the sergeants and the like, they are considered mercenaries. They're considered the absolute bottom of the barrel. They're considered the scum of the earth. They're spit upon by the officers as human fecal matter, except it's below fecal matter, because fecal matter can fertilize the soil, and you get enough rabbit shit and you can grow yourself some plants. Okay, these people are worthless for even that, as far as an officer is concerned. They're just human garbage to be expended, to be killed, to be sacrificed, to be tortured, to be experimented upon. That's what happens to them. You join the military, that's what happens to you. So in terms of what these non-commissioned officers have made the mistake of doing is they've entered a service, which is called a service because you serve. You're not working for remuneration. You're essentially stripped of everything. You're stripped of your humanity. You're stripped of your future. Nothing you learn will be employable in the civilian world. You will enter a world where you're repairing tank treads for the next 20 years. You go out to get a job in a garage. You will be entirely unemployable because there's no one who needs you to repair tank treads. You'll learn to operate a radar, radio detection and ranging. It's going to be absolutely useless in the real world. It will have nothing to do, even if you try to get a job with air traffic control. That's why most people in air traffic control have never had military experience. It's basically untransferable, any of your experience. So don't do it. Whatever you do, don't go in the military. You know, we can go into that later for other reasons. But basically, as a non-commissioned person, you are not commissioned, and therefore you are subject to one thing that is supposed to be in your favor. If you don't get paid, you don't have to fight. Now, that's all per the Uniform Code of Military Justice, and it's all in theory, but it is there, and when crunch comes to shove, it does mean something. Now, at the Battle of Gettysburg, which is largely and popularly considered, for what it's worth, to be the turning point of the American Civil War between the states, that doesn't mean to be, that doesn't mean that it's historically inviolate. That doesn't mean that Gettysburg was it, but Gettysburg was undeniably and inarguably very decisive. Now, Gettysburg was therefore something we should pay attention to. And what happened at that battle that could have been the turning point? All of the Union officers, the commissioned officers, were so corrupt, were so incompetent, were so vile as a class of people that they had never paid their troops for months and months and months, the better part of well over a year. So they were busy stealing all the money. They were busy stealing the payroll. And at the Battle of Gettysburg, all of the troops realized, you know what? We don't need to suffer this. And so they said, we can all go home. And so all of the generals, I'm not talking lieutenants, I'm not talking colonels, I'm talking generals, the field generals, had to go out in the field, hat in hand, begging the troops to fight to continue this grand experiment in Union to bring their errant brothers, the so-called rebels, back into the fold by force. And these non-commissioned personnel were all so stupid, so brainwashed, so incredibly naive that they went for it. And the Battle of Gettysburg was carried in Union favor to great misfortune of the entire world, including the African-American population. None of this was, of course, being fought for their benefit. All of this was fought for entirely different reasons from, quote-unquote, freedom of the slaves, because Abraham Lincoln had every intention of deporting every single black man and woman and child in America back to Africa as soon as he won the war. The only thing that stopped it was that a Confederate soldier blew his brains out. So you have a case of pure raw evil was intended towards the black population and towards the white population, which the Union had intended genocide for. And the only reason they didn't succeed in that was because the Southern population resisted, created a resistance movement, which had its own problems, its own infamy, known as the Ku Klux Klan, carried the day in terms of preventing white extermination during the era of Reconstruction, and then eventually, as many terrorist or resistance movements do, degenerate it into its own form of corruption and internal politics and kind of what we have today. Now, whether any of that can ever be rehabilitated is, of course, up to future generations to decide or this generation to decide. But my point should be well taken about the corruption of the Civil War because it goes into how the military runs this country. Now, in terms of all of these men fighting when they shouldn't have fought because they had never been paid, we go back to the commissioned officers. Now, what's the commissioned officer status mean? What does that mean when you're commissioned? It means that you have stock in the Incorporated States of America. That means America, the United States of America, is a corporation. You are a shareholder. You own stock in the nation. You do not have to be paid to fight. You have to fight no matter what because you've signed away the future of your entire family as investiture into the United States of America as a constitutional republic. Therefore, as a commissioned officer, you fight to the death. That is the theory. That is the difference between the commissioned and the non-commissioned. Now, for this reason, commissioned officers who all know this, who are all educated in this, who are all initiated into this, this is why they hold enlisted men in utter contempt. They view them as mercenaries. Now, how did this all start? It started with George Washington and his co-conspirators who served as the world's first conservative insurgency. And by conservative, I'm implying both political and financial, meaning they had something to conserve. Basically, what had happened was the royal proclamation that was issued by King George of the United Kingdom and the British Empire. And basically, in the 1700s, he issued a proclamation known as the Royal Proclamation, which said that the Atlantic states that formed the colonies of the Atlantic seaboard of the Maritime Republic of the United States, as we came to know it very shortly after the conservative insurgency began to unfold, was originally, of course, Royal America. Americans were known as Royal Americans, and many Americans had absolutely no reason to be dissatisfied with the lifestyle that they had under King George. So what happened was you had a King George who said, by the way, I don't want you colonizing any further inland. Beyond the Appalachian Mountains, we have French America. And French America is in a state of idyll. In other words, it's in a state of peace, meaning that the French traders, the fur traders, various other kinds of traders of French mercantile intent, were doing quite well marrying Native Americans. Their intercourse with Native Americans was probably the most progressive of all of the colonial powers. And they were doing a stunning business trading with the Indians and bringing their goods into what later became the United States. So King George said, there's no reason to interfere with that. Things are going quite well. You will colonize no further because so far you have been responsible for massive genocide and irresponsibility towards the native and indigenous peoples in your territories. And therefore, I don't want you destroying any more lives. Now, at that point in time, George Washington was known as the village burner in the Mohawk language because he had slaughtered thousands of Indians by burning their villages with all the women, children, and elderly inside and bayoneting and shooting all of the refugees as they tried to escape the burning villages to avoid burning alive. So he covered genocidal actions over multiple states in the United States that resulted in the murder of tens of thousands, ultimately hundreds of thousands of Indians. Personally oversaw this. So the man was psychotic. He was deranged. He was a mass murderer. He was a piece of human shit. And so this is your founding father, and it's gotten worse ever since. Now, George Washington made himself a commissioned officer. He commissioned himself as the general of the armies that founded this rotten republic, which we're all stranded in. And this individual, of course, got together with a bunch of other scumbags known as the founding fathers, such as, of course, Benjamin Franklin, Thomas Jefferson. These were criminals, and they were basically a bunch of white slave-owning, plantation-owning, misogynist pricks who said, let's start our own empire and tell King George to go F himself because we want it all. We want the entire continent. We'll take French America. We're going to stretch America from sea to shining sea. And they said, we're going to kill all the Indians and we'll steal all their land. We'll have it all for ourselves because we're conservative and we've got plantations. We've got slaves. We want it all and we want to stay that way forever. So anyone who looks back on this as some noble experiment is truly a fool. Especially if you're black. You're a black fool. If you think there's anything good in these founding fathers, they would have thought of you as a piece of human excrement, just like they think of everyone else, just like your leaders today of your military junta who run your nation think of you. And, of course, these were people who said that as commissioned officers who own stock in the nation, all of our enlisted men are expendable. So their enlisted men were the version of feudal serfs. These were like people who were like tilling the soil on their lands. And these people were pretty much helpless. And they were the peasantry of the United States. So when the longest declared war in American history took place, the longest declared war was the American Revolutionary War of Independence. It lasted 8 years from 1775. When the shot that was fired was heard around the world, 1775, all the way up to 1783 or something like that, when the British were forced to withdraw, you had an eight-year period of very terrible conflict in which Americans were fighting Americans because there were many Americans who fought against these scumbags. There were Americans who were loyal to the king. Those are the true heroes. And those individuals want to remain loyal to the crown instead of becoming traitors. And they were often annihilated and executed. And when the scumbags went out and established the genocidal republic, which later on turned its attentions towards the Indians inland and proceeded to exterminate so many more of them, we had a situation in which George Washington was able to give his version of a Gettysburg Address. And at that point, he said absolutely nothing about his enlisted men in terms of credit. He credited all his fellow commissioned officers for winning the war. Because as far as he was concerned, his enlisted men were nothing but subhuman peasants that were meant to take bullets. Now, anyone who has any doubt of this, just need to look up Shay's Rebellion. And what had happened was all of these enlisted men who had fought for 8 years lost everything because when you're called to fight, the reason you don't have to fight if you don't get paid is because think back to when they were fighting those times. These were men who lived off the land. These were men whose women and children, their families, depended on their being at home to stave off raiders, whether Indian or white. And they not only needed to be home to defend their families, they needed to be there to work the land. If they were not there to till the land, no crops were going to get grown. And women and children are not physically capable of
plowing, tilling, and doing everything else with the industriousness of your average male. And as a result, entire families starved to death. Your family could die. They could be raped, killed, murdered while you were gone by raiders, again, either Indian or white. They could be, of course, basically starving to death because they couldn't work the land. And as a result, of course, you were sacrificing everything while fighting for these conservative scumbags who owned plantations and slaves and were living fat. And talking about high ideals when they want to steal the rest of the continent, kill the Indians, and take everything else for themselves. Now, who wants to fight for that? Nobody sane wants to fight for that. So if you're not getting paid, you don't have to fight. So guess what? None of them got paid. So your original Ben Franklin, your original Thomas Jefferson, your original George Washington, all of these scumbags were so criminal that they never paid their men. And as a result, the men held Shays' Rebellion. They marched on the capital of Philadelphia. They pointed their muskets at the likes of Thomas Jefferson, at the likes of Hamilton and the rest of the original founding fathers, demanded their payment, and, of course, suffered the consequences of being attacked by the U.S. Army that was in service at the time, because other men getting paid are willing to kill men who didn't get paid. And the ringleaders of Shays' Rebellion were, of course, captured. They were hanged. And, of course, the capital was moved to Washington, D.C., District of Columbia. Named after another mass murderer, Christopher Columbus. Now, what is so important about the movement of the capital to this, 60 square miles of swampland or whatever that became essentially a sewer? Basically, the District of Columbia is not subject to posse comitatus. What does that mean? That means that they can kill you anytime they want because they can, because their government, it's not subject to the laws of the United States. Now, listen carefully to what I'm saying before you ever take children on a field trip to Washington, District of Columbia, before you ever decide to visit yourself as a tourist. Keep this in mind. Anytime they want, someone in Washington, D.C., who is an officer or an agent of the law, everyone from a policeman to a federal agent to a politician, has the right to take out a firearm and blow your brains out. Blow your brains out of your wife, out of your children. They could kill every single one of them, and they will face absolutely no legal consequences because there's no posse comitatus in effect in Washington, D.C. Now, this was carried out against the veterans after World War I. Who, guess what? They didn't get paid. So after World War I, the American Expeditionary Forces came back home. They weren't paid. And they were told they weren't going to be paid until 100 years later. And so they marched on Washington, D.C., and they said, we're going to stay camped out on Anacostia Flats. We're going to march in front of the White House until we get paid. So, of course, President Hoover had a solution. He had them all killed. He marched out the biggest scumbags in American military history, George S. Patton, General Douglas MacArthur, General Eisenhower. And, of course, Eisenhower was an assistant to General MacArthur at that time, who was in charge, of course, of pretty much the entire military. And you had, of course, General Patton, who at that time was not yet a general, but a young officer rising up in the ranks. And these three scumbags murdered their fellow servicemen because they were commissioned. They were always going to get paid. And they killed the people who didn't get paid. As a matter of fact, they used poison gas left over from World War I. They set the shanty town in which the veterans were camped out on across Anacostia Flats on fire. They came in with cavalry. And I don't know if you've ever seen a pregnant horse kicking a woman, but I had to burn photographs of such. And, they were basically trampling over women and children. And, of course, they killed a number of them. All of this was covered up by the government. And, of course, the gas was so powerful being left over World War I. Chemical agents, that it forced many pregnant women to miscarry. So they aborted many babies through involuntary assault. And it goes on and on. But basically, you've got a situation where that's Washington, D.C. for you. That's why they set it up the way they did, so that other veterans who marched and demanded to be paid, they could simply kill them. And then, of course, they've said that to everyone. They can kill anyone they want who goes to Washington, D.C. So unless you're a fool, you have no business going to Washington, D.C. The laws do not apply there. That would apply anywhere else in any state, because it's not a state. It is its own kingdom within a state within a state, a kingdom within a kingdom. So you know what to avoid now, both the military going to Washington, D.C., and ultimately you might have some idea of why your nation is not even worth fighting for, why you have no sane reason to fight for this nation, nor to admire its founding fathers. As a matter of fact, to put this in some perspective, because I myself was born in the Nationalist Republic of China, as reestablished onto the island of Taiwan. Obviously, my first language was Chinese. There is no traditional word in Chinese for quote-unquote independence. There's no traditional word in Japanese
for privacy. There are new terms. There are modern terms that have been introduced that get, of course, Japanized or Sinified for such concepts, but they're not a normal part of those cultures, which have lasted for thousands of years. Now, therefore, when you take the Declaration of Independence as written by the Founding Fathers, and the Chinese try to interpret it into their language, try to translate it or transliterate it as accurately or as literally as possible, they get a very telling translation. The closest concept in a Chinese iconograph or a pictograph, which would be like a character, as it's also called, there's their language, which is written, of course, in symbolic language as opposed to letters. The closest iconograph or pictogram that they have as a character to a concept of independence would be a criminal mindset. It would be something similar to conveying F everybody, every man for himself. So when the Declaration of Independence is translated into Chinese, it is translated as a criminal contract in which a bunch of criminals got together and basically decided to codify the concept of F everybody, every man for themselves. Now, that's an accurate translation as far as I'm concerned. That would be the true spirit of your Declaration of Independence, which, by the way, if you understood the Founding Fathers and the history behind that declaration, they basically originally phrased it, life, liberty, and the pursuit of property. And that's when they ran across a problem. They said, wait a second, we're going to be fighting the Brits. We got to take all of these peasants who are working our land, living off of nothing but the food that they're growing, our white slaves. How do we get our white slaves to fight for us? Well, they had to change it from life, liberty, and the pursuit of property to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And that way, of course, their troops could, since they're never going to get paid, at least be fighting for happiness. Now, all of this becomes incredibly, hysterically, tragically comedic. This is insane. It's insanity. And, of course, it didn't last, which is why there was almost a rebellion of a proletarian sort to destroy the victorious conservative revolution, which had won out in the original establishment of the American Republic, which now we suffer in. Now, inside of this American Republic, you are faced with a question, of course, that you brought up as to, okay, you're saying we're run by the military. How did that happen? How did we get to that point? And that, of course, is from the American Civil War between the states. Around that period of time, you had the southern states of the United States fighting for independence. Militarily, they were overwhelmed by the industry of the North. And this was because the American Civil War between the states was a railroad war. It was a war of industry. Now, people might argue that and say, well, the South was agricultural. The South, of course, had a cotton economy of exportation. They had, of course, slaves, and the African-American population far, far exceeded the master population of whites in the Deep South. And, of course, the problem was that they had to transport this cotton, the slaves, etc., so they were industrializing at least to the level where they could manufacture their weapons, etc., and as a result, of course, they had rails. So every major battle, people can look this up, within the American Civil War between the states, undeniably took place within 20 miles of track. It had to, because there's